This audiobook was created using text-to-speech software, and was not read by a real person. Please keep in mind the limitations of the technology when it comes to pacing and pronunciation. Also, if you enjoy the audiobooks we create, please consider supporting the expense of our projects through our Patreon page. Those who do so have access to exclusive book series, are able to download the MP3 files for all books we create, and also have early access to our normal YouTube releases. For more details, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. Thank you for listening, and we hope you enjoy the story. Star Wars: The Jedi Academy Trilogy, Book 3, Champions of the Force. Written by Kevin J. Anderson. Preview: Luke Skywalker has been trapped in the spirit plane by the evil Sith Lord, Exar Kun. As he fights desperately to stay alive, Leia is on a life-and-death mission of her own, to rescue her youngest son from Imperial assassins. Meanwhile, Han Solo tries to stop Kip Duran from carrying out an apocalyptic mission of mass destruction. Chapter 1. The Suncrusher plunged into the Carradine system, like an assassin's knife, into an unsuspecting heart. Old beyond his years, Kip Duran sat hunched over the controls, with dark eyes blazing, intent on his new target. With the might of the superweapon, as well as powerful techniques his spectral mentor Exar Kun had taught him, Kip would extinguish all threats against the New Republic. Only days before, he had annihilated Admiral Dalla and her two Star Destroyers in the Cauldron Nebula. On the fringes of the explosion, he had dropped off one of the Suncrusher's coffin-sized message pods so that the galaxy would know who was responsible for the victory. As his next target, Kip would challenge the Imperial Military Training Center on Carita. The military planet was a largish world with high gravity to toughen the muscles of potential stormtroopers. Its untamed land masses provided an appropriate range of training environments: Arctic wastelands, trackless rainforests, splintered mountain crags, and searing desert hardpan crawling with venomous multi-legged reptiles. Carita seemed the opposite of Kip's peaceful homeworld of Deer, where he and his family had lived in raft colonies on the calm terraformed lakes, but that peace had been shattered years ago when Kip's parents had chosen to protest the destruction of Alderaan. Stormtroopers had crushed the colony, whisking Kip and his parents to the spice mines of Kessel while conscripting his brother Zeth for the Stormtrooper Training Center. Now, as he orbited the military planet, Kip's face bore the tight, hardened look of a person who has been through the raging fire of his own conscience. Shadows rimmed his eyes. He did not expect to find his brother still alive after so many years, but he intended to learn the truth. And if Zeth was not there, Kip had enough power to destroy the whole Carradine solar system. A week ago, he had left Luke Skywalker for dead atop the Great Temple on Yavin 4. He had stolen design parameters of the Suncrusher from the mind of its naive creator, Kui Zux. And he had blown up 5 stars to incinerate Admiral Dalla and her 2 Star Destroyers. At the last moment, Dalla had tried to flee the exploding stars, but to no avail. The shock waves had been intense enough to blank the Suncrusher's viewscreens even as fire overtook Dalla's flagship, the Gorgon. Since that awesome victory, Kip's obsession had gained momentum, and he had set out on a hyperspeed course toward annihilating the Empire. The Carradine defense network spotted the Suncrusher as Kip entered orbit. He decided to transmit his ultimatum before the Imperial forces tried anything stupid. He broadcast on a wide range of frequencies. "Carradine Military Academy," he said, trying to deepen his voice. "This is the pilot of the Suncrusher." His mind searched for the name of the ambassadorial buffoon who had caused a diplomatic incident on Coruscant by tossing his drink in Mon Mothma's face. "I wish to speak to Ambassador Fergan to discuss the terms of your surrender." The planet below made no response. Kip stared at the comm system, waiting for noise to burst from the speaker. His alarm consoles flashed as the Carradines attempted to lock onto the suncrusher with a tractor beam, but Kip worked the controls with Jedi-enhanced speed, oscillating his orbit at random so they could never get a positive lock. "I am not here to play games." Kip's hand bunched into a fist and slammed down on the comm unit. "Carita, if you do not answer within the next 15 seconds, I'll fire a torpedo into the heart of your son. I think you're familiar with the capabilities of this weapon. Do you understand?" He began counting out loud. 1, 2, 3, 4, he got up to 11 before a brusque voice came through the comm system. "Intruder, we are transmitting a set of landing coordinates. Follow them precisely or you will be destroyed. Relinquish control of your ship to the stormtroopers immediately upon landing." "You don't seem to understand what's going on here," Kip said before he bothered to stop laughing. "Let me talk to Ambassador Fergan now, or your planetary system is going to be the galaxy's newest bright spot. I've already blown up a nebula to wipe out a pair of Imperial battle cruisers. Don't you think I'd destroy one minor star to get rid of a planet full of stormtroopers? Get Fergan, and give me a visual." The hollow panel flickered, and the wide, flat face of Fergan appeared, shoving aside the comm officer. Kip recognized the ambassador by his heavy eyebrows and fat purplish lips. "Why have you come here, rebel?" Fergan said. "You are in no position to make demands." Kip rolled his eyes, losing patience already. "Listen to me, Fergan. I want to find out what happened to my brother, Zeth. He was conscripted on the planet Deer about 10 years ago, and he was brought here. Once you have that information, we'll discuss terms." Fergan stared at him, knitting his heavy spiked brows. "The Empire does not negotiate with terrorists. You don't have any choice in the matter." Fergan fidgeted and finally backed down. "It will take some time to access information that old. Maintain your position in orbit, and we'll check." "You have 1 hour," Kip said, then signed off. On Carita, in the main citadel of the Imperial Military Training Center, Ambassador Fergan looked down at his comm officer, frowning with lips the color of fresh bruises. "Check that boy's words, Lieutenant Doran. I want to know the capabilities of that weapon." A stormtrooper lieutenant marched in with a precise military stride that sent shivers of admiration down Fergan's spine. "Report," he said to the captain. The helmet speaker amplified the stormtrooper's voice. "Colonel Ardax announces that his assault team is ready to depart for the planet Anoth," he said. "We have 8 MTAT vehicles loaded into the dreadnought Vendetta, along with a full complement of troops and weaponry." Fergan tapped his fingers on the polished console in front of him. "It seems an extravagant effort to kidnap a baby and overcome a single woman who's watching him, but this is a Jedi baby, and I will not underestimate the defenses the rebels may have emplaced. Tell Colonel Ardax to prepare his team for immediate departure. I have a minor irritation that needs to be dealt with here, and then we can go fetch a young, malleable replacement for the Emperor." The stormtrooper saluted, whirled on one polished boot, and exited through the chamber doors. "Ambassador," the comm officer said, scanning readouts, "we know from our spy network that the rebels had a stolen Imperial weapon called the Suncrusher, which can supposedly trigger the explosion of a star. And there was a mysterious multiple supernova in the Cauldron Nebula less than a week ago, just as the intruder claims." Fergan felt a thrill of anticipation as his suspicions were confirmed. If he could get his hands on the Suncrusher and the Jedi baby, he would have more power at his disposal than any of the squabbling warlords in the core systems. Carita could perhaps become the center of a blossoming new empire, with Fergan at its helm as regent. "While the Suncrusher pilot is distracted and awaiting news of his brother," Fergan said, "we shall mount a full-fledged assault to cripple his craft. We can't let such an opportunity escape us." Kip stared at the Suncrusher's chronometer, growing angrier with each ticking interval. If it weren't for the hope of learning news about Zeth, Kip would have launched one of his 4 remaining resonance torpedoes into Carita's sun and backed off to watch the system explode in a white-hot supernova. With a surge of static, the Carradine comm officer's image appeared before him, contrite and businesslike. To the pilot of the Suncrusher, you are Kip Duran, brother of Zeth, whom we recruited on the colony world, dear? The officer spoke with a plodding voice, enunciating each word with unnecessary precision. I gave you that information already. What have you learned? The comm officer seemed to fade out of focus. We regret that your brother did not survive initial military training. Our exercises are very strenuous, designed to discourage all but the best candidates. Kip's ears filled with a roar like rushing water. He had expected the news, but confirmation sent despair through him. What were the circumstances of his death? Checking, the comm officer said. Kip waited and waited. During a mountain survival tour, he and his team were snowed in by a sudden blizzard. He appears to have frozen to death. There is some indication he made a heroic sacrifice so other members of his team could survive. I have the full details in a file. I can upload it if you like. Yes, Kip said, his mouth dry. Give me everything. He recalled an image of his brother, two boys throwing small reed boats into the water and watching them drift toward the marshes, then the look on Zeth's face after stormtroopers had crashed into their home and dragged him away. This will take a moment, the comm officer said. Kip watched the data scroll across his screens. He thought of Exar Kun, the ancient lord of the Sith who had shown him many things that Master Skywalker refused to teach. The news of Zeth's inevitable death was like severing the remaining threads of Kip's fragile restraint. Nothing could stop him now. He would show murderous Karida no mercy. Kip would remove this Imperial thorn from the New Republic's side and then move on to topple the big Imperial warlords gathering their forces near the galactic core. He waited for Zeth's files to finish uploading into the Suncrusher's memory. It would take a long time for him to absorb all those words, to imagine every detail of his brother's life, the life they should have had together. Emerging from the thin veil of atmosphere at the limb of the planet, a battle group of 40 TIE fighters roared toward him. Another cluster of 20 came from the opposite horizon in a pincer formation. The ploy of Zeth's files had merely been a delaying tactic to keep him preoccupied as the Carradines launched an attack. Kip didn't know whether to be amused or outraged. A grim smile flickered across his face, then vanished. The TIE fighters came in, firing what must have been intended as crippling laser blasts. Kip felt the thumps of their impacts against the Suncrusher, but his special quantum-layered armor could withstand even a turbo laser blast from a Star Destroyer. One of the TIE pilots contacted Kip. We have you surrounded. You cannot escape. Sorry, Kip said. I'm fresh out of white flags. He used his sensors to track the lead TIE fighter from which the message had come. He targeted with his defensive lasers and let loose a volley that strafed across the ship's flat solar panel. The TIE ship broke apart in a flower of white and orange flame. The other fighters retaliated from all sides. Kip targeted with his own defensive lasers, selecting 5 victims. He managed to strike 3. Using the extreme mobility of the Suncrusher, he accelerated upward just as the surviving TIE fighters sent return fire through the expanding explosions of his first round of victims. Kip laughed out loud as 2 of the fighters hit each other in the crossfire. The wall of anger rose and strengthened in him, increasing his reservoir of power. He had already given more warning than the Carradines deserved. Kip had stated his ultimatum, and Fergan had sent out attack ships. That's the last mistake you'll ever make, he said. The TIE fighters continued to fire, missing more often than not. Laser bolts spanged off his armor, causing no damage. The pilots did not seem to know how to target and shoot properly. They had probably spent all their time practicing in simulation chambers, without ever fighting an actual space battle. Kip relied instead on the Force. He shot back, obliterating another ship, but decided that further fighting was not worth his time. He had a bigger target. 2 fast TIE interceptors streaked after him as he pulled out of planetary orbit and set a course for the star at the heart of the system. The only damage they could possibly do to the Suncrusher would be to take out its tiny laser turrets. Dala's forces had once succeeded in disabling the Suncrusher's external weaponry, but New Republic engineers had repaired it. Another breached TIE fighter spurted flash-frozen atmosphere as it exploded. Kip darted through the debris, straight toward the sun. The surviving Imperials charged after him, still firing. He paid them no heed. Over and over in his mind he rolled images of Zeth, imagining his brother frozen and hopeless in a training exercise for an army he had never wanted to join. The only way for Kip to cauterize that memory was to purge the entire planet with fire, a fire only the Suncrusher could unleash. He activated the firing systems for his resonance torpedoes. The high-energy projectile would be pumped out in an oval-shaped plasma discharge from the toroidal generator at the bottom of the Suncrusher. Last time Kip had fired the torpedoes into supergiant stars in a nebula. Karita's sun was an unremarkable yellow sun, but even so, the Suncrusher could ignite a chain reaction within the core. As Kip swooped in toward the blazing ball of yellow fire, flickering prominences reached out of the star's chromosphere. Boiling convection cells lifted hot knots of gas to the surface, where they cooled and sank back into the churning depths. Dark sunspots stood out like blemishes. He sighted on one of the black spots as if it were a bullseye. Kip primed the resonance torpedo and spared a moment to glance back. His TIE pursuers had split off, unwilling to come so close to the glaring sun. Failsafe warning systems flashed in front of Kip, but he disregarded them. When the control system winked green, he depressed the firing buttons and shot a sizzling green-blue ellipsoid deep into Karita's sun. Its targeting mechanisms would find the core and set up an irrevocable instability. Kip leaned back in the comfortable pilot's seat with a sigh of relief and determination. He had passed the point of no return. He should have felt elated, knowing it was only a matter of time before the military academy was finally extinguished. But that knowledge could not wash away the grief he felt for the loss of his brother. Alarms screamed through the citadel of the military training center. Stormtroopers ran along flagstone halls, taking emergency positions at strategic points as they had been drilled, but they didn't quite know what to do. Ambassador Fergan's face held a comical expression of shock. His bulging eyes looked as if they might pop out of their sockets. His lips scraped together as he fought for words. But how could all of our TIE fighters miss? They didn't miss, sir, Comm Officer Doran said. The Suncrusher seems to have impenetrable armor, better than any shielding we've ever encountered. Kip Duran has reached our sun. Although our readings are scrambled from coronal discharges, it appears that he has launched some sort of high-energy projectile. The Comm Officer swallowed. I think we know what that means, sir. If the danger is real, Fergan said. Sir, Doran wrestled with rising agitation, we have to assume it's real. The New Republic was pointedly uneasy about being in possession of such a weapon. The stars in the Cauldron Nebula did explode. Kip Duran's voice broke over the intercoms. Karita, I warned you, but you chose to trick me instead. Now accept what you've brought upon yourselves. According to my calculations, it'll take 2 hours before the core of your sun reaches a critical configuration. He paused for a beat. You have that amount of time to evacuate your planet. Fergan slammed his fist down on the table. Sir, Doran said, what are we going to do? Should I organize an evacuation? Fergan leaned over to flick a switch, toggling to the hangar bay in the lower staging area of the Citadel. Colonel Ardax, muster your forces immediately. Get them aboard the dreadnought Vendetta. We will launch our Anoth assault team within the hour, and I will accompany them. Yes, sir, the reply came. Fergan turned to his Comm Officer. Are you certain that boy's brother is dead? Nothing we can use for leverage. Doran blinked. I don't know, sir. You told me to delay him, so I made up a story and sent a fake file. Do you want me to check? Of course I want you to check. Fergan bellowed. If we can use the brother as a hostage, perhaps we can force that boy to neutralize the effects of this suncrusher weapon. I'll get on it immediately, sir, Doran said, and hammered his fingertips on the data pads. Six of Ferdin's training commanders, summoned by the wailing alarms, marched into the control center and saluted briskly. Standing shorter than his commanders, Ferdin clasped his hands behind his back, pushing his chest out as he addressed them. Take an inventory of all functional ships on Kurita. Everything. We need to download the data cores from our computers and take as many personnel as possible. I doubt we'll be able to evacuate them all, therefore, choices will be made on the basis of rank. Are we just going to abandon Kurita without a fight? One of the generals said. Ferdin screamed at him, the sun is going to blow up, general. How do you propose to fight that? Evacuation on the basis of rank? Doran said in a small voice, looking up from his panel. But I'm only a lieutenant, sir. Ferdin scowled down at the man hunched over his control panels. Then that gives you all the more incentive to find that kid's brother, and force him to rescind that torpedo. Through half-polarized viewports, Kip watched the surviving TIE fighters pull away and swoop back toward Kurita. He smiled with satisfaction. It would be good to watch the Carradine's panicked scramble as they tried to grab everything of value on an entire planet. Over the next 20 minutes he watched streams of ships launch away from the main training citadel, small fighters, large personnel transports, Starworker space barges, and one deadly-looking dreadnought battleship. Kip was annoyed at himself for allowing the Imperials to haul so much weaponry away. He was sure it would eventually be used against the New Republic, but at the moment Kip took his pleasure from eradicating the solar system. You can't escape, he whispered. A few might get away, but you can't all escape. He glanced at his chronometer. Now that instabilities had begun pulsing out of the star, he could get a more accurate determination of how long it would take for the sun to explode. The Carradines had 27 minutes before the first shockwave struck. The flow of ships had petered out, and only a few scrapheap vessels struggled out of the gravity well. Kurita did not appear to be well supplied with vessels, most of their prime equipment must already have been commandeered by Grand Admiral Thrawn or some other Imperial warlord. The hollow panel flickered, and the image of the comm officer appeared. Pilot of the Suncrusher. This is Lieutenant Doran calling Kip Duran, this is an emergency, an urgent message. Kip could well imagine that anyone still on Kurita might have an urgent message. He took his time answering just to make the comm officer squirm. Yes, what is it? Kip Duran, we have located your brother Zeth. Kip felt as if someone had thrust a lightsaber through his heart. What? You said he was dead. We checked thoroughly and found him in our files after all. He is stationed here in the Citadel, and he has not managed to find transport off Kurita. I've summoned him to my comm station. He'll be here in a moment. How can that be? Kip demanded. You said he died in training. I have the files you sent me. Falsified information, Lieutenant Doran said bluntly. Kip squeezed his eyes shut as hot tears sprang to fill his vision, sudden overwhelming joy at knowing Zeth was still alive, anger at having committed the most fundamental mistake of all, believing what the Imperials told him. He snapped a glance at the chronometer. 21 minutes until the explosion. Kip wrenched at the Suncrusher's controls and shot back toward the planet like a laser blast. He doubted he had enough time to rescue his brother, but he had to try. He stared at the time display ticking away. His vision burned, and he felt a jolt go through him every time a number ticked down. It took 5 minutes to get back to Kurita. He orbited around the massive planet in a tight arc, crossing over the line from night into day. He set course for the small cluster of fortresses and buildings that made up the Imperial Training Center. Lieutenant Doran appeared again in the small holographic field, dragging a white-armored stormtrooper into view. Kip Duran. Please respond. I'm here, Kip said. I'm coming to get you. The comm officer turned to the stormtrooper. 2112, remove your helmet. Hesitantly, as if he had not done so in a long time, the stormtrooper tugged off his helmet. He stood blinking in the unfiltered light as if he rarely looked at the world through his own eyes. Kip saw a heartrending image that reminded him of the face he saw when he looked in a reflection plate. "State your name," Doran said. The stormtrooper blinked in confusion. Kip wondered if he was drugged. 2112, he said. "Not your service number, your name." The young man paused for a long time, as if pawing through rusty, unused memories until he came out with a word that sounded more like a question than an answer. "Zeth. Zeth Dur, Duran." Kip didn't need to hear him speak his name, though. He remembered the tanned, wiry boy who swam in the lakes of Deir, who could catch fish with a small hand net. "Zeth," he whispered. "I'm coming." The calm officer waved his hands. "You can't make it in time," he said. "You must stop the Suncrusher torpedo. Reverse the chain reaction. That's our only hope." "I can't stop it," Kip answered. "Nothing can stop it." Doran screamed, "If you don't, we're all going to die." "Then you're going to die," Kip said. "You all deserve it. Except for Zeth. I'm going to come for him." He plowed like thunder through the high atmosphere of Karida. Heated air purled off the sides of the superweapon as a shock front pushed a shield in front of him. Sonic booms rippled behind him. The planet's surface approached with gut-wrenching speed. Kip soared over a cracked, blasted wasteland with craggy red rocks and fractured canyons. Out in the flat desert he saw geometric shapes, tracks of precise roads laid down by the Imperial Corps of Engineers. The Suncrusher shot like a meteor over a cluster of bunkers and metallic huts. Isolated stormtroopers marched about in drills, unaware that their sun was about to explode. On the chronometer, 7 minutes remained. Kip called up a targeting screen and found the primary citadel. The air tugged at his ship, buffeting him with heavy winds, but Kip did not care. Flames from the ignited atmosphere flickered off the quantum armor. "Give me your specific location," Kip said. The comm officer had begun sobbing. "I know you're in the main citadel building," Kip cried. "Where exactly?" "In the upper levels of the southernmost turret," Zeth answered precisely, responding in a military manner, slipping back into stormtrooper training. Kip saw the jagged spires of the military academy rising from a cluttered plateau. Kip's scanners projected an enlarged image of the citadel, pinpointing the turret Zeth had mentioned. 5 minutes remained. "Zeth, get ready, I'm coming in. To rescue us both," Doran said. Kip felt a twinge inside. He wanted to leave the comm officer who had lied to him, who had made him despair and forced him into the decision to destroy Karida. He wanted to let the lieutenant die in a burst of incinerating solar flame, but that man could help him, for now. "Get yourselves into an open area. I'm going to be there in less than a minute. You can't get up to the roof in time, so I'm going to blast it off." Doran nodded. Zeth finally overcame his own confusion and said, "Kip?
My brother?"
"Kip, is that you?" The Suncrusher streaked over the jagged minarets and pinnacles of the Caridan Citadel. A mammoth wall surrounded the entire fortress. Out in the courtyard, hundreds of low-ranking refugees scrambled about in tiny flyers aiming up into the skies, though with no hyperdrive capability they could never outrun the fury of the supernova. Kip decelerated abruptly until he hovered over the fortress. Suddenly the Suncrusher lurched from side to side as automatic perimeter lasers targeted him and fired. "Shut down your defenses," he screamed at the comm officer. He wasted time targeting and firing at the perimeter lasers. Two of the weapon emplacements blew up in roiling smoke, but the third, a blaster cannon, scored a direct hit against the Suncrusher. The superweapon spun end over end, out of control until it smashed into one of the tall turret walls. Kip managed to get control again and raised the vehicle up. No time to vent his anger. No time to do anything but get to the tower. Kip watched the chronometer click down from 4 minutes to 3. "Take shelter," he said. "I'm going to blast open the roof." He targeted with one of his weapons and fired, but he received an error message. The laser turret had been damaged by his collision with the tower. Kip swore and spun the ship around so he could target with a different laser. After a short controlled burst, the roof of the tower melted inward. Chunks of Sinrock and metal reinforcement girders sprayed into the air. Kip flicked on his tractor beam to yank the debris away before it could collapse into the lower floors. He brought the suncrusher over the smoking crater that had been the rooftop. He pointed his scanners down and saw two people scramble out from under the desks where they had taken shelter. 2 minutes. Kip hovered over them. If he lowered his ship, they could reach the ladder to the hatch, where they could climb into the shielded suncrusher. He already had an escape route programmed in. As Kip dropped toward them, Lieutenant Doran stood up and battered Zeth on the back of the skull with a broken plasteel shard. Zeth fell to his knees, shaking his head and pulling out his blaster in reflex. The comm officer ran to the suncrusher's ladder, but Kip, furious at seeing what Doran had done, raised the ship out of the man's reach. Scrambling, waving his arms, the comm officer jumped up to reach the rungs of the ladder, but he missed and slapped his hands across the hull instead. The quantum armor was still smoking hot from Kip's fiery plunge through the atmosphere. Doran screamed as it burned his hands. Falling back to the ground, Doran turned just in time to see Zeth point the blaster at him. With precise stormtrooper training, Zeth targeted and fired. The comm officer flew backward, his chest a black hole. He collapsed among the debris. 1 minute. Kip maneuvered the suncrusher back into position, lowered the ladder, but Zeth collapsed to his knees, blood streamed down the back of his head, streaking the white stormtrooper armor. Zeth could not move. He had been too badly injured by the comm officer. Thinking rapidly, Kip locked on to his brother's limp form with the tractor beam, yanking him up off the floor and drawing him toward the suncrusher. This would be it. Kip left the controls and scrambled to the hatch. He would have to open the hatch, climb down the ladder, and haul his brother up inside. He reached for the locking mechanism that would open the suncrusher. And then Karita's sun exploded. The shock wave roared through the atmosphere, bringing instant incinerating fire. The entire citadel turned into a storm of flames. The suncrusher tumbled end over end, and Kip flew against the far wall of the cockpit, his face plastered against one of the external view screens. He saw the faint afterimage of Zeth's body disintegrating into a fading silhouette as the stellar energy ripped across Karita. Kip hauled himself into the pilot's seat. In shock, he used his Jedi instincts to punch the sublight engines. The first wave from the supernova had been the prompt radiation, high-energy particles shot out with the explosion of the star. A minute or so later, the heavier radiation would come. As rippling waves from the second hurricane of energy struck Karita and cracked the planet open, the suncrusher accelerated far beyond its red lines along the pre-programmed escape route. Kip felt gravity stretching his face into a grimace. His eyelids squeezed closed, and anguished tears flowed backward across his temples with the pull of acceleration. The suncrusher blasted out of the atmosphere and entered hyperspace. As starlines formed around him, and the supernova made one last grab with hands of flame, Kip let out a long anguished cry of despair at what he had done. His scream vanished with him, into hyperspace. Chapter 2. Leia Organa Solo emerged from the Millennium Falcon on Yavin 4, ducking her head as she walked down the landing ramp. She looked toward the towering edifice of the Great Misasi Temple. It was a cool morning on the jungle moon, and mist rose from the ground, clinging to the low treetops and brushing against the stone ziggurat like a thin white shroud. A funeral shroud, she thought. For Luke. It had been a week since the trainees at the Jedi Academy had found Luke Skywalker's motionless body atop the temple. They had brought him inside, done their best to care for him, but they did not know what to do. The best New Republic medics had found no physical damage. They agreed that Luke still lived, but he lay in complete stasis. He responded to none of their tests or probes. Leia had little hope of doing anything herself, but she could at least be with her brother. The twins came clomping down the Falcon's ramp, seeing who could make the loudest banging noises with their small boots. Han stood between Jason and Jaina, holding their hands. "Be quiet, you two," he said.
"Are we going to see Uncle Luke?"
Jaina asked.
"Yes," Han answered, "but he's sick. He won't be able to talk to you."
"Is he dead?"
Jason asked.
"No,"
Leia answered sharply.
"Come on. Let's get into the temple."
The twins scampered ahead down the ramp. The sharp jungle smells brought warm and fresh memories to Leia as she walked across the clearing. Fallen trees, decaying leaves, and flowers mixed into a potent brew of scents. She had proposed the empty ruins as a site for Luke's academy, but Leia had never managed to visit, and now she had come only to see her brother lying in state.
"I'm not looking forward to this," Han mumbled.
"Not at all."
Leia reached over to squeeze his hand. He gripped hers, holding tighter and longer than she expected him to. Robed figures emerged from the temple, drifting out of the early morning shadows. She quickly counted a dozen. In the lead she recognized the rusty orange face of a Calamarian female, Silgal. Leia herself had seen Jedi potential in the fish-like woman and had urged her to join Luke's academy. Silgal had managed to use her proven ambassadorial skills to hold the 12 students together in the terrible days following the fall of their Jedi master. Leia recognized other candidates gliding across the dew-damp ground: Streen, an older man with wild hair tucked haphazardly beneath a Jedi hood. He had been a gas prospector on Bespin, a hermit hiding from the voices he heard in his head. She saw tall Kirana T, one of the witches of Dathomir whom Leia and Han had encountered during their whirlwind courtship. Kirana T stepped forward, flashing a bright smile at the twins. She had a daughter of her own, only a year or so older than the twins, who remained in the care of others back on her homeworld. Leia also identified Tion, with long silvery hair that flowed down the back of her robe. Tion was a student of Jedi history, who wanted desperately to be a Jedi herself. Then came hard-bitten Cam Solosar, a once-corrupted Jedi whom Luke had dragged back to the light side. And Dorsk 81, a streamlined, slick-skinned alien who had been cloned generation after generation, because his society believed they had already developed the perfect civilization. Leia didn't recognize the other handful of Jedi candidates, but she knew Luke had been diligent in his Jedi search. The call still rang out across the galaxy, inviting those with the potential to become new Jedi Knights. Even though their teacher now lay in a coma. Silgal raised a flippered hand.
"We are glad you could come, Leia."
"Ambassador Silgal," she said.
"My brother, has there been any change?"
They walked heavily back toward the oppressive temple. Leia believed she already knew the answer.
"No," Silgal shook her squarish head.
"But perhaps your presence will do something that ours cannot." Sensing the solemn mood, the twins refrained from giggling and exploring the musty, stone-walled rooms. As the party entered the gloomy ground-level hangar bay, Silgal led Leia, Han, and the twins to a turbolift.
"Come on, Jason and Jaina," Han said, grabbing their hands again.
"Maybe you can help Uncle Luke get better."
"What can we do?"
Jaina asked, her liquid brown eyes wide and hopeful.
"I don't know yet, honey," he said.
"If you come up with any ideas, let me know."
The turbolift doors flowed shut, and the platform rose to the top levels of the temple. The twins clung to each other in sudden uneasiness. They had not recovered from their fear of turbolifts since the last time they had ridden one all the way down to the decaying bottom levels of Imperial City. But the ride was over in a moment, and they stepped out into the grand audience chamber of the great temple. Skylights spilled sunlight on a broad, polished stone promenade that led to a raised stage. Leia remembered standing on that stage years before, after the Death Star had been destroyed, presenting medals to Han, Chewbacca, Luke,
and the other heroes of the Battle of Yavin. Now, though, her breath caught in her throat. Han groaned beside her, a deep, grieving tone that she had never heard him make before. On a bier at the end of the room lay Luke, like a body stretched out for a funeral in an echoing, empty chamber. Her heart thumped with dread. She wanted to turn around so she wouldn't have to look at him, but Leia's feet compelled her forward. She walked with a rapid step that became a run before she reached the end of the promenade. Han followed, carrying the twins, one in each arm. His eyes were red as he fought to keep tears from flowing. Leia already felt a wetness on her cheeks. Luke lay in repose, swathed in his Jedi robe. His hair had been combed, his hands were folded across his chest. His skin looked gray and plastic-like. "Oh, Luke," she whispered. "Too bad you can't just thaw him out," Han said, "like you rescued me from Jabba's palace." Leia reached out to touch Luke. Using her own abilities with the Force, she tried to reach deeper, to brush against his spirit, but she felt only a cold hole, an emptiness as if Luke himself had been taken away. Not dead. She had always felt she would somehow know if her brother died. "Is he sleeping?" Jason said. "Yes, in a way," she answered, not knowing what else to say. "When will he wake up?" Jaina asked. "We don't know," she said. "We don't know how to wake him up. Maybe if I give him a kiss." Jaina clambered up to smack the motionless lips of her uncle. For an absurd moment Leia held her breath, thinking that the child's magic just might work. But Luke did not stir. "He's cold," Jaina mumbled. The little girl's shoulders slumped with disappointment when her uncle failed to wake. Han squeezed Leia's waist so hard that it hurt, but she didn't want her husband to stop holding her. "He's been unchanged for days," Silgal said behind them. "We brought his lightsaber with him. We found it beside his body on the rooftop." Silgal hesitated, then moved to stare down at Luke. "Master Skywalker told me I have an innate talent for healing with the Force. He had just begun to show me how to develop my skills, but I've tried all I know. He is not sick. There's nothing physically wrong with him. He seems frozen in a moment of time, as if his soul has left and his body is waiting for him to come back. Or," Leia said, "waiting for us to find a way to help him return." "I don't know how," Silgal said in a thin, husky voice. "None of us knows, yet. But perhaps working together we can figure it out. Do you have any inkling about what really happened?" Leia asked. "Have you found any clues?" She could sense the sudden spike of Han's turmoil. Silgal looked away with her big Calamarian eyes, but Han answered with grim certainty. "It was Kip. Kip did this." "What?" Leia said, whirling to stare at him. Han answered in a tumble of words. "The last time I saw Luke, he told me he was afraid for Kip." Han swallowed hard. "He said that Kip had started dabbling in the dark side. The kid stole Mara Jade's ship and took off somewhere. I think Kip came back here and challenged Luke." "But why?" Leia asked. "What for?" Silgal nodded, as if her head were too heavy for her. "We did find the stolen ship in front of the temple. It is still here, so we don't know how he flew away again, unless he fled into the jungles." "Is that likely?" Leia asked. Silgal shook her head. "We Jedi trainees have pooled our talents and searched. We do not detect his presence on Yavin 4. He must have left on another ship somehow." "But where would he get another ship?" Leia asked, but suddenly she remembered astonished New Republic astronomers reporting the impossible news that an entire group of stars in the Cauldron Nebula had gone supernova at the same time. She whispered, "Could Kip have resurrected the Suncrusher from the core of Yavin?" Han blinked. "How could he possibly do that?" Silgal hung her head gravely. "If Kip Duran has managed that, then his power is far greater even than we feared. No wonder he was able to defeat Master Skywalker." Han shuddered, as if afraid to accept what he knew was true.
Leia could sense his emotions like a maelstrom within him.
If Kip is on the loose with the Suncrusher, he said, then I'll have to go and stop him.
Leia snapped around to look at him, thinking how Han always leaped headfirst into challenges.
Are you getting delusions of grandeur again? Why does it have to be you?
I'm the only one he might listen to, he said.
He looked aside, staring down at Luke's cadaverous face.
She saw his lips trembling.
Look, if Kip doesn't listen to me, then he won't listen to anyone, and he'll be lost forever.
If his power is as great as Silgal thinks, that kid is not an enemy the New Republic can afford to have.
He gave one of his lopsided grins.
Besides, I taught him everything he knows about flying that ship.
He couldn't possibly do anything to me.
It was a somber dinner with the Jedi trainees. Han used the Falcon's food synthesizers to create a repast of heavy Corellian food. Leia picked at some spiced, fried strips of a woolamander that Karana T had hunted in the jungle. The twins stuffed themselves with messy fruits and berries.
Dorsk 81 devoured a bland and unappealing-looking meal of heavily processed food cubes.
Conversation was minimal, little more than forced pleasantries.
They all feared to discuss what really preoccupied them, until Kem Solosar said in a hard-edged voice, "We hoped you would bring us news, Minister Organa Solo.
Give us some guidance as to what we should do here.
We are Jedi students with no master.
We've learned a little, but not enough to continue training on our own."
Tion broke in.
"I'm not sure we should try to learn things we don't understand.
Look what happened to Gentaurus.
He was consumed by some evil thing he inadvertently found.
And what about Kip Duran?
What if we get lured to the dark side without knowing it?"
Old Streen stood up and shook his head.
"No, no.
He's here.
Don't you hear the voices?"
When everyone turned to look at him, Streen sat down and hunched his shoulders, as if trying to hide under the Jedi robe.
He sniffled and cleared his throat before continuing.
"I can hear him.
He's whispering to me now.
He talks to me always.
I can't get away from him."
Leia felt a rush of hope.
"Luke.
You can hear Luke talking to you."
"No."
Streen whirled at her.
"The dark man.
A dark man, a shadow.
He talked to Gentaurus.
He talked to Kip Duran.
You shine the light, but the shadow always stays, whispering, talking."
Streen placed his hands against his ears and pressed his temples.
"This is too dangerous," Karana T said, knitting her eyebrows.
"On Dathomir I've seen what happens when a large group falls to the dark side.
The evil witches on my planet made things terrible for centuries, and the galaxy was saved only because they had no spaceflight.
If the witches had managed to spread their dark workings from star system to star system."
"Yes, we should all stop our Jedi exercises," Dorsk 81 said, blinking his large yellow eyes.
"This was a bad idea.
We shouldn't have even tried."
Leia slapped both her hands hard on the table.
"Stop this talk," she said.
"Luke would be ashamed to hear his students saying such things.
With attitudes like that, you'll never become Jedi Knights."
She fumed.
"Yes, there is a risk.
There will always be risks.
You've seen what happens to someone who isn't careful, but that simply means you must be careful.
Don't be seduced by the dark side.
Learn from the sacrifice that Gentaurus made.
Learn from how Kip Duran was tempted.
Learn from the sacrifices your master made in an attempt to protect you all."
She stood and looked at each one of them.
Some flinched.
Some met her gaze.
"You are the new generation of Jedi Knights," she continued.
"That is a great burden, but you must bear it, because the New Republic needs you.
The old Jedi protected the Republic for 1,000 generations.
How can you give up after the first challenge?
You have to be the champions of the Force, with or without your Jedi Master.
Learn as Luke learned, step by step.
You must work together, discover the things you don't know, fight what has to be fought.
But the one thing you can't do is give up.
She is right, Silgo said in her maddeningly calm voice. If we surrender, the New Republic will have one less weapon against evil in the galaxy. Even if some of us fail, the rest of us must succeed. Do or do not, Karana T said, and Tion finished the phrase that Master Skywalker had drilled into them. There is no try. Her heart pounding, her stomach watery, Leia slowly sat down. The twins stared at their mother in amazement, and Han gripped her hand in admiration. She breathed deeply, began to let herself relax. When suddenly a strangling outcry of death shattered her soul. It sounded like an avalanche within the Force, an outcry of thousands upon thousands of lives wiped out in an instant. Around the table the other Jedi candidates, all those sensitive to the Force, clutched at their chests or their ears. Streen let out a long wail. It's too many, too many. Leia's blood burned through her veins. Painful claws skittered down her spine, plucking her nerves and sending jolts through her body. Both of the Jedi twins were crying. Baffled, Han grabbed Leia's shoulders and shook her. What is it, Leia? What happened? He apparently had felt nothing. What? She gasped. It was a great disturbance in the Force. Something terrible just happened. With a cold wash of dread, Leia thought of young Kip Duran, turned to the dark side, and now armed with the Suncrusher. Something terrible, she said again. But she could not answer Han's other questions. Chapter 3. The Force moved through all things, weaving the universe into an invisible tapestry that tied the smallest living creature to the largest star cluster. Synergy made the total far greater than the sum of its parts. And when one of those threads was torn, ripples spread through the entire web. Actions and reactions, great shock waves that affected all who could hear. The destruction of Karita screamed through the Force, building power as it reflected off other sensitive minds. It rose to a tumult that struck. And woke. Sensory perceptions rushed back to Luke Skywalker like a storm, freeing him from the smothering nothingness that had trapped and frozen him. His final shout still echoed in his ears, but now he felt strangely numb. The last thing he remembered was the serpent-shaped tendrils of black force wrapping around him. Rising from the summons of Exar Kun and Luke's misguided student Kip Duran, the serpents of Sith power had sunk their fangs into him. Luke had been unable to resist their combined might. He had tried to use his lightsaber, but even that had failed. Luke had fallen into a bottomless pit deeper than any of the black holes in the Maw cluster. He did not know how long he had been powerless. He remembered only an emptiness, a coldness, until something had jarred him loose. Now, as the sudden clamor of sensory impressions filled him, it took him some time to sort out and make sense of what he could see: the walls of the grand audience chamber, the lozenge-shaped stones, the translucent tiles set out in hypnotic patterns, the long promenade and the empty benches spread like frozen waves on the floor, where once the entire Rebel Alliance had celebrated their victory over the first Death Star. Luke's head buzzed, and he felt giddy. He wondered why he should feel so insubstantial, until he looked down, and saw his own body still lying prone and motionless below him, eyes closed, face expressionless. Astonishment and disbelief blurred Luke's vision, but he forced himself to focus again on his own features. He saw the faded scars from when the Wampa ice creature had attacked him on Hoth. His body was still draped with the brown Jedi robe, his hands crossed lightly on his chest. The lightsaber lay at his hip, a cylinder of silent plasteel, crystals, and electronic components. What's going on? Luke said out loud. Hello. He heard the words thrum through his head like vibrating transmissions, but they made no sound at all in the air. Finally Luke looked at himself, the part of himself that was aware, and saw an insubstantial image, like a ghost reflection of his body, as if he had reconstructed a hologram using his impression of what he looked like. His spectral arms and legs appeared to be garbed in a flowing Jedi robe, but the colors were washed out and weak.
Everything was sketched with a lambent blue glow that sparkled as he moved. With a rush of awe and astonishment, Luke suddenly knew what had happened. Several times he had encountered wavering spirits of Obi-Wan Kenobi and Yoda, and his own father, Anakin Skywalker. Was he dead, then? It sounded ludicrous because he didn't feel dead, but he had no point of comparison. He recalled how Obi-Wan's and Yoda's and Anakin's bodies had all vanished upon their deaths, Obi-Wan and Yoda leaving only crumpled robes, Anakin Skywalker leaving only the empty body armor of Darth Vader. Why, then, had his own body remained intact, stretched out on the raised platform? Could it be because he was not yet entirely a Jedi Master, completely given over to the Force, or could it be that he was not truly dead? Luke heard a whirring as the turbolift rose to the top chamber. The sound seemed eerie and unnatural, as if he were using senses other than his ears to hear. The turbolift doors slid open. R2-D2 extended his front wheeled foot and rolled out, moving slowly, almost respectfully, along the polished stone promenade. The droid proceeded toward the raised platform. Luke's shimmering image stood in front of his body where it lay in state, and he watched with joy as the little astromech droid came to him. "R2, am I glad to see you," he said. He expected the droid to bleep with wild excitement. But R2 gave no indication that he heard or detected Luke. "R2." R2-D2 trundled up the ramp to Luke's shrouded body. The droid hooted, a low, mournful sound that expressed deep grief, if droids could feel such emotions. It tore Luke apart to see his mechanical friend looking at the body, his optical receptor winked from red to blue and back again. Luke realized that the droid was taking readings, checking on his body's condition. He wondered if R2 would detect anything different, now that Luke's spirit had been set free, but the droid gave no sign. Luke attempted to move over to R2, to touch the polished barrel-shaped body. It took him a moment to figure out how to move his ghostly legs. His image skimmed across the floor with a dizzying fluidity. But when he stroked R2, his hand passed directly through. He felt no contact with the plasteel of the droid's body, no sensation of the floor against his ethereal feet. Luke tried walking completely through the droid, hoping somehow to scramble R2's sensors, but R2 continued to take readings, unperturbed. The droid gave another sad hoot as if in farewell, then spun around and whirred slowly back toward the turbolift. Luke called out. "Wait, R2!" But he held little hope the droid would hear. A quick idea came to him. Rather than using his illusory hands, he reached out with the Force. He thought of how he and Gantoris had used little nudges from the Force to rattle metal antennas in the airborne ruins of Tibonopolis on Bespin. Luke reached out invisibly to tap R2's shell, hoping to make a loud spang that would at least let the droid know something was amiss. He pushed and thumped with all his intangible might, and succeeded only in what he thought was a barely audible bump against the droid's metal casing. R2 paused, but while Luke gathered strength to make another Force assault, the droid dismissed the unexplained sound and entered the turbolift. Inside the turbolift, R2 turned his optical sensor once more toward the body of his master, made a low, sliding whistle, and then the doors whisked closed. Luke heard the humming of the platform as it dropped back down to the lower levels of the great temple. Luke stood in the echoing grand audience chamber all alone, awake again, but insubstantial and apparently powerless. He would have to find some other way to solve his predicament. He looked out through the temple skylights into the blackness of the jungle moon's deep night, and he wondered what he could do to save himself. Chapter 4. With a Wookiee bellow of impatience, Chewbacca urged the last members of the Special Forces team onto the remaining troop transport. The other transports had been shuttling up and down from Coruscant orbit all day, carrying weapons, equipment, and personnel to the strike force already assembled in space. The heavily armed battle group consisted of one escort frigate and four Corellian corvettes, enough firepower to occupy the secret Imperial think tank, Maw installation, and to overcome any resistance from the weapons scientists stranded there. The last three stragglers hustled up the ramp, clad in light armor and securing tight packs onto their shoulders. Chewbacca watched the soldiers strap into their seats before he punched the "all clear" button to raise the boarding ramp.
"Your impatience is not helping, Chewbacca," C-3PO said. "The tension level is already substantial, and you're simply making things worse.
I have a bad feeling about this mission already."
Chewbacca growled at him, disregarding his comment.
Impatient, he picked up the droid and dropped him with a metallic clatter into the only remaining spare seat, which was, unfortunately, next to Chewbacca's own.
"Indeed," 3PO said as he dutifully hooked himself in.
"I'm doing my best. This isn't my area of expertise, you know."
Chewbacca settled into a seat that had never been designed to accommodate a creature of his massive proportions. He bent his hairy knees nearly to chest level. He wished he could be with Han in the Millennium Falcon, but Han and Leia had gone to see Luke Skywalker, and Chewbacca felt his stronger duty was to go rescue the Wookiee prisoners left inside Maw installation. The rest of the assault team shifted in their seats, looking around, double-checking their mental lists of equipment and procedures. Paige's commandos, a crack assault troop, would be handling most of the frontline mission, with plenty of New Republic firepower to back them up. The Special Operations Commander, General Crix Maydeen, had given the Special Forces thorough briefings on strategy for the planned occupation. The soldiers were fully trained and competent. Chewbacca just wished the pilot would hurry up and take off. He blew out a long sigh through his rubbery lips, thinking uneasily of Han. He had waited a long time for an opportunity to rescue the tortured Wookiee slaves, though. When he, Han, and young Kip Duran had been captured by Admiral Dalla at Maw installation, Chewbacca had been forced to work with captive Wookiees aboard the Star Destroyers and down in the installation itself. The Wookiees had been imprisoned for more than 10 years, working at hard labor, and the resistance had gone out of them. The thought of their ruined lives made Chewbacca's blood boil. Not long ago, with 3PO's dubious abilities as translator, Chewbacca had addressed the New Republic Council. He urged them to occupy the installation and rescue the Wookiee prisoners, as well as to keep the new weapon designs from falling into Imperial hands. Seeing Mon Mothma's support, the Council had agreed. With a mechanical whir and a thump of metal against metal, the landing struts of the transport drew up inside the hull. With a lurch, the transport rose on its repulsor lifts, then headed off the landing platform, rising into the sky as the metropolis of Imperial City glittered below. 3PO began talking to himself. Chewbacca marveled at how sophisticated the droid's electronic brain must be to consistently find so many things to complain about.
"I simply don't understand why Mistress Leia ordered me to go with you. I am always happy to serve in any capacity, naturally, but I could have assisted greatly in watching the children while she visited Master Luke on Yavin 4. I've been doing a good job of taking care of the twins, haven't I?"
Chewbacca grunted.
3PO continued. "True, we misplaced them at the holographic zoo for extinct animals, but that was only one time, and it all turned out right in the end." He swiveled his golden head. As the acceleration increased, Chewbacca closed his eyes and growled at him to be quiet.
3PO ignored him. It would have been nice to see R2-D2 again at Master Luke's Jedi Academy. "I haven't spoken to my counterpart in a long time."
3PO did not slow down as he changed subjects. "I really don't know what use I'm expected to be on this military mission. I've never been very skilled at combat. I don't like combat. I don't like excitement in any form, though I seem to have encountered enough of it." Inertia pushed Chewbacca back against his uncomfortably small seat as the transport accelerated toward the congregation of battleships in orbit around Coruscant.
3PO continued, and continued. "Of course I understand that I am technically supposed to help sift through the data in the Maw installation computers, and I suppose I could be of some use translating the languages of alien scientists, but certainly there must be some other droid better qualified for that type of work. Isn't General Antilles taking along an entire team of slicer droids to get encrypted information? Paige's commandos are experts in this sort of thing. Why do I have to go along and do all the hard work?"
It seems unfair to me. Chewbacca barked a sharp command. 3PO turned to him with his yellow optical sensors glowing in indignation.
I will not be quiet, Chewbacca. Why should I listen to you after you put my head on backward in Cloud City? If you yourself had spoken up during the preparations for putting this team together, you could have convinced them to let me stay with Mistress Leia. But you thought I might be an asset to this mission, and now you're just going to have to listen to me. With a sigh of annoyance, Chewbacca reached over and hit the power switch on the back of 3PO's neck. The droid fell silent, his words slurring to a stop as he slumped forward. On the troop transport, Page's commandos, noted for their intense training, cold efficiency, and utter professionalism, took a moment to applaud Chewbacca's action. On the command bridge of the escort frigate, Yavaris, General Wedge Antilles looked across space. Sunlight reflected off the metal hulls of his fleet. He had asked for command of this mission because he wanted to return to where Qui Zux had spent so much of her life, to where the secrets of her lost memory might lie hidden. The Yavaris was a powerful ship, despite its fragile appearance caused by the thin spine that separated its two primary components. At the frigate's aft end, a boxy construction contained sublight and hyperdrive engines and the power reactors that drove not only the engines but also 12 turbolaser batteries and 12 laser cannons. On the other end of the connecting rod, separated from the engines, was the much larger command section, hanging down in an angular structure that contained the command bridge, crew quarters, scanners, and cargo bays that carried two full X-wing fighter squadrons for the assault. The escort frigate held a crew of about 900 seasoned soldiers, while the rest of his fleet, four Corellian corvettes, carried 100 on each vessel. Wedge brushed his dark hair away from his forehead and set his square jaw. The last of the troop transports had docked on the frigate, bringing the remainder of the hand-picked raiders. Han Solo had reported that Maw installation was no longer protected by Admiral Dala's Star Destroyers, which had been lured out of the black hole cluster to wreak havoc across the galaxy. The precious weapons information and scientists inside the installation were undefended. Probably. Wedge was prepared for surprises, especially from a congregation of Imperial weapons designers. On the command bridge of the Yavaris, Wedge toggled on the intercom. Prepare to depart, he said. The four corvettes folded around the escort frigate in a diamond formation. Ahead, Wedge saw throbbing blue-white light as banks of heavy engines pulsed to life. The corvette's huge engines were twice as large as the living compartments and the hammerhead-shaped control section. Princess Leia had been riding a corvette when Vader's Star Destroyer had captured her, demanding that she return the stolen Death Star plans, so long ago. He watched the light-embroidered nightside of Coruscant veer away from the fleet as they angled up out of orbit, past metallic docking stations and heavy parabolic mirrors that directed magnified sunlight to warm the higher frozen latitudes. He wished Qui had stayed with him to watch the departure, but she was down in their quarters reviewing information tapes, studying. Since her memory would not come back of its own accord, Qui intended to fill the gaps with the missing information as quickly as possible. She also had a deep revulsion toward watching a planet from orbit. It had taken Wedge much quiet encouraging before she finally told him that the sight reminded her of her youth, when she had been held hostage aboard an orbital training sphere under the harsh tutelage of Moff Tarkin. Qui had been forced to watch, as Victory-class Star Destroyers obliterated the honeycomb settlements of her people whenever students failed their examinations. Thinking of the terrible things the Empire had done to the delicate and lovely Qui made Wedge clench his teeth. He turned to the bridge crew. Ready for hyperspace? Course set, sir, the navigation officer answered. Wedge vowed to do what he could to fill Qui's life with joy, once they had conquered Maw installation. Move out, he said. Inside windowless quarters in the protected lower decks of the Yavaris, Qui Zux stared into the tutorial screen and blinked her indigo eyes. She skimmed file after file, absorbing the information as enthusiastically as a Tatooine desert sponge grabbed droplets of moisture. A small portrait hollow of Wedge sat inside a cube atop her work table. She glanced at it frequently, reminding herself what he looked like,
who he was, how much he meant to her. None of her memories were certain after Kip Duran's assault on her mind. She had initially forgotten Wedge himself, forgotten the times they had spent together. He had desperately told her everything, showed her pictures, taken her out to the same places that the two of them had visited on the planet Ithor. He had reminded her of the reconstruction site of the Cathedral of Winds they had visited on Vortex. Some of these things caused elusive images to flicker in the back of her mind, enough that she knew they had been there once, but she could not grasp them anymore. Other things Wedge told her exploded back into her thoughts with full clarity, enough to bring stinging tears. Whenever that happened, Wedge was there to hold her in his arms and comfort her. "No matter how long it takes," he had said, "I'll help you to remember. And if we can't find all of your past again, then I'll help you make new memories to fill those spaces." He brushed her hand, and she nodded. Qui reviewed the tapes of her speech before the New Republic Council, where she had insisted that they dispose of the Suncrusher and stop trying to analyze it. The council members had grudgingly agreed to mothball the project by plunging it into the core of a gas giant planet. But now it appeared that this had not been sufficient to keep the superweapon away from an anger and determination as powerful as Kip Duran's. As she reviewed the holotaped speech she had given, she heard the words in her own voice, but did not remember speaking them. She placed the memories in her mind, but they were external views of herself as seen and recorded by others. She heaved a deep breath and scrolled to the next data file. A cumbersome method, but it would have to do. Much of her basic scientific knowledge remained intact, but certain things were completely gone: insights she had gained, new weapons designs, and new ideas she had developed. It seemed that when Kip had rummaged around in her brain, yanking out anything that had to do with the Suncrusher, he had erased whatever he found questionable. Now Qui had to rebuild what she could. It didn't bother her that knowledge of the Suncrusher had been obliterated. She had previously vowed to tell no one how the weapon worked, and now telling would be impossible, even if she wanted to. Some inventions were better erased. The Maw assault fleet had been underway for almost a full day, heading toward the Kessel system. Qui had been studying much of the time, sparing only a moment to talk to Wedge when he came to visit after completing his duties on the command bridge. When he brought her food, they ate together, making small talk, spending their time looking into each other's eyes. As she sat at the data terminal, Wedge would come and stroke her narrow shoulders, massaging until her tense muscles turned buttery and warm. "You're working too hard, Qui," he had said more than once. "I have to," she answered him. She recalled her youth, when she had studied desperately, cramming knowledge of physics and engineering and weaponry into her pliable young brain for Moff Tarkin. She alone had survived the rigorous training. Kip's heavy-handed scouring of her mind had left her with those painful childhood memories, memories she would just as soon forget. There were some things she could not recapture from data tapes or tutorial programs. She had to go back inside Maw installation, into the laboratories where she had spent so many years. Only then could she determine which memories would come back and how much of her past she would have to sacrifice forever. The intercom rang out, and Wedge's voice flooded into their quarters. "Qui, would you come up to the bridge, please? There's something I'd like you to see." She acknowledged, smiling at the sound of his voice. She took a turbolift up to the frigate's command towers and stepped out onto the bustling bridge. Wedge turned to greet her, but her indigo eyes were drawn to the broad viewport at the front of the Yavaris. She had seen the Maw cluster before, but her mouth still dropped open in awe. The incredible maelstrom of ionized gases and superheated debris screamed past the edges of the bottomless black holes in a great whirlpool of color. "We came out of hyperspace near the Kessel system," Wedge said, "and we're lining up our vector to go in. I thought you might want to watch." She swallowed a lump in her throat and stepped forward to take his hand. The black holes formed a maze of gravity wells and dead-end hyperspace paths, only a few dangerously safe courses made passage possible through the tangled labyrinth. "We downloaded the course from the Suncrusher," Wedge said. "I hope nothing's changed, or we'll all have a big surprise when we try to make it through." Qui nodded. "It should be safe," she said.
I double-checked the route.
Wedge looked at her warmly, as if her verification gave him more confidence than all the computer simulations.
The black hole cluster was an impossible astronomical oddity. For thousands of years astrophysicists had attempted to determine its origin, whether some freak galactic combination had led to the birth of the black holes, or whether some impossibly ancient and powerful alien race had assembled the cluster for its own purposes. The Maw sent out deadly radiation and was even now drawing the Kessel system to its eventual doom. For the present, though, the Empire had found a stable island within the cluster and had built its secret laboratory there.
Let's go then, Kui said, looking out at the brilliant gases flaring in incredible slow motion.
She had much to learn, and a score to settle.
I'm ready.
The ships of the Maw assault fleet spread apart, arrowing one by one, into the heart of the black hole cluster.
Chapter 5.
One wing of the rebuilt Imperial Palace had been converted into a creche for the water-loving Calamarian people, humid quarters for those brought by Admiral Akbar, and trained as his specialized starship mechanics. The creche had been built of smooth plasteel and hard metal, fashioned to look like a reef within the towering palace. Some of the round portholes looked out upon the glittering skyline of Imperial City, while others gazed in on an enclosed water tank that circulated around the rooms like a trapped river. A loud venting of mist from the humidity generator startled Terpfen out of nervous contemplation. He looked around his quarters wildly, swiveling his circular eyes, but he saw nothing in the shadows, only a jewel-blue light shining through the water windows. He watched as a gray-green glurpfish oozed its way along the channel, filtering microorganisms from the brine. No sound intruded other than the steam generators and bubbling aerators in the wall tanks. Terpfen had heard nothing in his mind, felt no compulsion from his Imperial masters on Karita for more than a day, and he didn't know whether to be frightened, or hopeful. Fergan usually taunted and jabbed him regularly, just to remind him of his constant presence. Now Terpfen felt alone. Rumors flew around the Imperial Palace. Distress signals had been detected from Karita, and then all contact had broken off. New Republic scouts had been dispatched to inspect the area. If Karita had somehow been destroyed, then perhaps the Imperial hold on his brain had been severed. Terpfen could finally be free. He had been taken prisoner during the vicious Imperial occupation of the water world Calamari. Like many of his people, Terpfen had been dragged to a labor camp and forced to work at the starship construction facilities. But Terpfen had been damned to undergo a special kind of training. Taken off to the Imperial military planet of Karita, he had suffered weeks of torture and conditioning as xenosurgeons removed portions of his brain and replaced them with vat-grown organic circuits that allowed Fergan to use Terpfen as a perfectly disguised puppet. The poorly stitched scars on his swollen head had served as badges of his ordeal once he was released. Many Calamarians had also been severely tortured during the occupation, and no one suspected Terpfen of treachery. For years he had tried to resist his Imperial masters, but half of his brain was not his own, and the Imperial controllers could manipulate him at will. He had sabotaged Admiral Akbar's expanded B-wing fighter so that it crashed on Vortex, destroying the precious Cathedral of Winds and disgracing Akbar. Terpfen had planted a tracer on another B-wing, which had allowed him to obtain the location of the secret planet Anoth, where baby Anakin Solo lived in isolation, protected from prying eyes and minds. Terpfen had passed that crucial information to a greedy Ambassador Fergan. Even now the Karadans must be mounting an attack to kidnap the third Jedi child. Terpfen stood before the aquarium window in his dim quarters, watching the glurpfish sluggishly go about its business. An aquatic predator swooped toward it, flailing spear-tipped fins and jagged jaws. The predator would fall upon the glurpfish, just as the Imperial forces would fall upon the helpless child and his lone protector, Winter, who had once been Leia's close companion and confidant. No. Terpfen smashed his flipper hands against the thick glass. The vibrations startled the fanged predator, and it shot away in search of other prey. The protoplasmic glurpfish, unaware of what had just happened, continued on its way, sifting the water for microscopic food.
Perhaps his Caridan masters had only been distracted temporarily by other things, but if Turpfen hoped to accomplish anything, he had to make his move now. He swore that it didn't matter what damage it did to his own brain. Akbar himself remained in self-imposed exile on Calamari, working with his people to repair the floating cities that had been devastated in Admiral Dalla's recent attack. Akbar claimed to have no further interest in New Republic politics. Since an assault was to be launched against young Anakin, Turpfen would go directly to Leia Organa solo. She could mobilize New Republic forces and thwart the Imperials. But she and Han Solo had just departed for the jungle moon of Yavin. Turpfen would have to go there, commandeer a ship, and meet her face to face. He would confess everything and put himself at her mercy. She might execute him on the spot, as would be her right. But even that would be a just punishment for the damage he had already done. His mind made up, at least for as long as it remained his mind, Turpfen took a last look around his quarters. Turning from the aquarium windows that reminded him of the homeworld he had left behind, he took a last glance at the faceted skyline with its kilometer-high skyscrapers, winking landing lights, gleaming shuttles rising toward the aurora that blanketed the night. Turpfen doubted he would ever see Coruscant again. He didn't have time for a ruse. Using his own security access codes, Turpfen entered the starfighter servicing bay and walked briskly, confidently. His body odor was laced with tension, but if he moved fast enough, no one would notice until it was too late. The large launch doors had been sealed for the night. Two Calamarian starship mechanics stood around one of the B-wing fighters. A group of chattering Ugnaughts worked under the hyperdrive motors of a pair of X-wing fighters that had been jacked together to exchange navicomputer information. Turpfen walked toward the B-wing. One of the Calamarians saluted him as he approached. The other lowered herself out of the pilot compartment, slinging down a webbed sack of tools. From his own terminal, Turpfen had already checked the status of this fighter, knew it was ready to launch. He didn't have to ask the question, but it distracted them. "Repairs completed as planned?"
"Yes, sir," the male Calamarian said.
"What are you doing up so late?"
"Just attending to some personal business," he said, and reached into a pocket of his flight suit. He whipped out a blaster pistol set to stun. He fired in a sweeping arc, catching both Calamarians with blue ripples. The male slumped to the ground without a sound. The female dangled on the rung, unconscious as she thumped against the side of the B-wing. Finally her elbow went slack, and she dropped to the hard floor in a tumble. Over by the X-wings the Ugnaught stopped chattering and stood up in amazement, then they began squealing. Three ran to the comm alarm next to the controls of the launch doors. Turpfen took aim and squeezed the firing button again, cutting the Ugnaughts down. The others raised their stubby hands in surrender, but Turpfen could not risk taking captives, so he stunned them as well. Moving purposefully, he hurried across the slick-plated floor to the controls of the launch door. From the enameled badge on his left breast, he withdrew a disguised slicer chip the Imperials had provided months ago, in case he should need to make a quick escape. Now, though, Turpfen used the Imperial technology for the benefit of the New Republic. Turpfen jammed the small wafer into the input slot and punched three buttons in succession. The electronics hummed, scanning the information in the chip. The slicer chip convinced the controls that Turpfen had the appropriate override codes, that he had authorization from both Admiral Akbar and Mon Mothma. With a groan and a thud, the heavy launch doors split apart. The night winds whistled outside the hangar bay, gusting into the chamber and bringing the chill air. Turpfen strode to the repaired B-wing, slid his broad hands under the arms of the fallen male Calamarian, and dragged him across the slick floor. He dumped the mechanic beside the slumped bodies of the stunned Ugnaughts. When Turpfen moved the female mechanic, she moaned softly. Her arm hung at an awkward angle, broken in the fall. Turpfen hesitated a moment in guilty misery, but the accidental injury couldn't be helped. A few hours in a Bacta tank would patch her up just fine. By then Turpfen would be on his way to Yavin 4.
He clambered into the pilot seat of the B-Wing and powered up the controls. All the lights winked green. He sealed the hatch. With the speed of the B-Wing's engines, he could make it to the Yavin system in record time. He had to. Terpfen raised the awkward-looking craft on its repulsor lifts and maneuvered toward the open launch doors. Screeching alarms penetrated the enclosed cockpit, vibrating from the servicing bay. Terpfen twisted his head to see what had gone wrong, and spotted another Ugnaught, one who had apparently been hiding inside the cockpit of an X-Wing. The lone Ugnaught had squirmed out in a panic and scurried over to the alarm panel. Terpfen cursed under his breath and knew that he had to hurry. He had hoped not to fight his way out. He punched the maneuvering jets and shot out of the wide mouth of the launching bay. His stolen B-Wing streaked away from the immense towers of Coruscant and headed out on a high-energy straight-line path to orbit. He couldn't waste time fooling the New Republic security monitors. Terpfen would appear to be an Imperial saboteur stealing a starfighter. If they captured him, they would interrogate him until it was too late to help young Anakin Solo. Terpfen had done many terrible things against his will, but now that he was free from Imperial control, any failure would be his own fault. He could blame no one else. It surprised and dismayed him how rapidly the Coruscant security forces scrambled to intercept him. Four X-Wings soared by at low altitude and vectored in on his single fighter. Terpfen's comm buzzed. One of the pursuing pilots said, "B-Wing, you have made an unauthorized departure from the palace. Return immediately, or you will be fired upon." Terpfen merely increased power to the shields surrounding his ship. The B-Wing was one of Akbar's prize contributions to the rebellion, and it was far superior to the old model X-Wings. Terpfen could outrun them, and his shields could probably survive several direct hits, but he didn't know if he could withstand the combined firepower of four X-Wings. "B-Wing fighter, this is your last chance," the X-Wing pilot said, and fired a low-energy bolt that spattered against Terpfen's shields. The warning shot nudged the B-Wing, but caused no damage. Terpfen punched the throttle, kicking in the afterburners that launched him toward the Aurora and a low planetary orbit that his onboard navigational systems marked with heavy red danger lines. A year before, the battle to regain Coruscant and overthrow the warring Imperial factions had been won only at the cost of incredible destruction. Many ruined battleships remained in low orbit, collected there in a great garbage pile. Crews had been dismantling them for months, repairing those that could be salvaged, sending others down to burn up as they made their spectacular descent through the atmosphere. Such work, though, had low priority during the crisis phase of the formation of the New Republic. A large junkyard of debris still orbited in well-marked lanes. Terpfen, however, had previously scanned the placement of the twisted hulks and made his own personal orbital chart. He had found a dangerous path through the maze, so narrow he would have to fly with no margin for error, but it seemed his best chance. He was certain the alarm had sounded across Coruscant's full security systems, and before long squadrons of fighters would come screaming in to converge on him. Terpfen didn't want to fight. He didn't want to cause more death and damage. He wanted to escape as quickly and as painlessly as possible. As he left the blanket of atmosphere behind him, the X-Wings followed in his wake, firing in earnest now. Terpfen refused to shoot back, although if he crippled one or more of the starfighters, he would have an easier time escaping. But he did not want the death of an innocent pilot on his conscience. He had too many deaths to deal with already. In the blackness of space he flitted past glimmering shards of metal, reactor pods, and hull plates from blasted freighters. He skimmed up and over a tangled cluster of girders and a largely intact planar solar array from a destroyed TIE fighter. Up ahead the breached hull of a capital ship, a Lorner strike cruiser, hung as little more than a framework of structural beams and split plating after its hyperdrive engines had blown up during a direct hit. Terpfen streaked toward the hulk, knowing that the blast cavity in its middle was wide enough for a B-Wing to pass directly through. He had already studied the path, and he hoped the risk would cause his pursuers to pull back and give him just enough time to launch into hyperspace. Without slowing, Terpfen shot through a gaping opening in the strike cruiser's hull. Two X-wings peeled off, another managed to follow directly in his wake. The fourth shifted a micron too far and clipped its wings against a ragged strut. The X-wing spun and slammed into the wreckage, its fuel cylinders detonated. Turpfen felt claws of dismay sink into his heart. He had never meant for anyone to die. The last X-wing hung hotly behind him, firing repeatedly in outrage at the death of his partner. Turpfen checked his shields and saw that they had begun to fail under the pummeling. He did not blame the other pilot for his anger, but neither could he surrender now. He studied his control panels. The navicomputer had plotted the best course to the Yavin system. Before his shields could buckle, Turpfen took a short course directly out of the orbital debris field. The X-Wing came at him again with all weapons blazing. Upon reaching open space, Turpfen punched the hyperdrive engines. In an instant the B-Wing shot forward, impossibly out of the reach of the other fighter. With white star lines that looked like spears to impale him, Turpfen vanished into hyperspace with a silent bang.
Chapter 6. Standing in front of the Millennium Falcon, Han Solo held Leia in a long embrace. The oppressive humidity of the jungle moon clung to them like wet rags against their skin. Han hugged Leia again, smelling her scent. The corners of his lips drifted upward in a wistful smile. He could feel her trembling against him, or perhaps it was his own hands. "I really do have to go, Leia," he said. "I've got to find Kip. Maybe I can stop him from blowing up more star systems and killing more people."
"I know," she said. "I just wish we could arrange to have our adventures together a little more often." Han tried unsuccessfully to give her his famous no-care grin.
"I'll work on it," he said, then he kissed her long and hard.
"Next time we'll manage." He bent down to gather the twins in his arms. Jason and Jaina clearly wanted to go back inside and play in the temples. The children had found a small group of furry woolamanders nesting in an unused wing of the great temple, and Jason claimed in his broken sentences that he knew how to talk to the creatures. Han wondered just what the hairy and noisy arboreal animals were saying back to the boy. He backed toward the boarding ramp. "You know I need you to stay here in safety with the kids," he said to Leia.
"And with Luke."
She nodded. They had been through this all before.
"I can take care of myself.
Now, get going. If you can do anything to stop Kip, you shouldn't be wasting time here." He kissed her again, waved goodbye to the twins, and vanished into the ship. In a rotating cocktail lounge high up in Imperial City, Lando Calrissian yanked the fruit stick out of his drink before it could take root at the bottom of the glass. He sipped the fizzy concoction and smiled across the table at Mara Jade.
"Sure I can't get you another drink?" he asked.
She looked absolutely beautiful with her exotic hair, high cheekbones, generous lips, and eyes the color of expensive gemstones. She hadn't touched her first drink yet, but he made certain he still shone with confidence.
"No thanks, Calrissian. We've got business to discuss."
The windows of the observation lounge showed the glittering former imperial palace and crystal-like spires and skyscrapers that extended to the fringes of the atmosphere. Hover barges drifted above the buildings, flashing announcements in numerous languages, ferrying tourists out to watch the sunset and the brightening aurora. A pair of mismatched moons hung in the sky, shining down on the bustling city. Musical notes drifted into the air from a complex multi-layered bank of keyboards in the middle of which sat a purplish-black, tentacled creature. With a flurry of cilia, the creature played a staggering number of keys at a time. Instead of eyes on its lumpy head, it was studded with tympanic membranes of varying sizes so it could hear music over an incredible range. Its tentacles flailed, striking upper keys, drawing out lower resonances, playing tunes both too high and too low for the human ear. Lando took another sip and leaned back in his chair with a sigh and a soft smile. He had draped his slick burgundy cape over the back of his chair. Mara Jade wore only a tight-fitting jumpsuit, her curves looked like hazardous paths through a complicated planetary system. Lando looked across at her. So you think the Smugglers' Alliance would be interested in an arrangement for distribution of glitterstem spice from Kessel?
Mara nodded.
I think I can guarantee that.
Morath Duel let the spice mines fall into a shambles.
Black market smuggling from the Imperial Correction Facility has made the entire planet a pain in the soft parts for any self-respecting runner trying to earn a living. It took powerful crime lords like Jabba with enough strong arm just to make it worthwhile.
I'll make it worthwhile, Lando said, folding his hands together on the tabletop.
I received a 1,000,000 credit reward from the Duchess of Dargul, and I can invest it to bring the systems up to a more sophisticated level.
What exactly are your plans?
Mara asked, leaning closer to him.
Lando responded by leaning over the table himself, bringing his large brown eyes close to hers.
His pulse raced.
She frowned and sat up straight again, still waiting for him to answer.
Rebuffed, Lando looked for words.
I don't have any great fondness for the prison where Duel centered his operations, but I think I can use that as a starting point.
Dismantle most of the old correctional facility, but use the buildings for a new base.
And I don't plan to use slave labor, either.
I figure we can get worker droids.
On Niklon I got familiar with some sophisticated mining systems, and if I use super-cooled devices, the infrared signatures won't attract those energy spiders that caused so much trouble before.
Droids can't handle everything, Mara said.
You're going to need some people down there.
Who will you get to run a miserable operation like that?
Miserable to humans maybe, Lando said, locking his hands behind his back and sitting straight, but not to some other species.
In particular, I've got in mind an old friend of mine, Nian Nunb, who was my co-pilot on the Falcon during the Battle of Endor.
He's a Celestin, a little creature who grew up living in tunnels and warrens on a tough volcanic world.
He'd consider the spice mines a luxury resort.
Lando shrugged at Mara's skeptical look.
Hey, I've worked with him before and I trust him.
Sounds like you've got most of the answers, Calrissian, Mara said.
But so far it's all just talk.
When are you planning to go to Kessel and get to work?
Well, I lost my ship there.
I've got to get back to Kessel to pick up the Lady Luck and start my operations.
He raised his eyebrows.
Say, you wouldn't be willing to give me a lift to the system, would you?
No, Mara Jade stood up.
I would not.
All right, then.
Will you meet me on Kessel in one standard week?
By then I should have a good feel for how things are going to go.
We can lay down the foundation for a long and lasting relationship.
He smiled at her again.
Business relationship, she said, but not quite as sharply as she might have.
You sure you won't have dinner with me? He asked.
I've already eaten a ration bar, she said, and turned to leave.
One standard week.
I'll see you on Kessel.
She turned and left.
Lando blew her a kiss, but she didn't see him, which was probably a good thing.
At the keyboards, the tentacled musician played a mournful tune of unreciprocated emotional resonances.
In the stuffy council chambers, Han Solo swallowed a lump in his throat, before he addressed the gathered senators and generals, and Mon Mothma herself.
I don't often talk to this, he tried to think of the appropriate flowery language Leia would use in front of politicians, this, August assemblage, but I need some information fast.
Mon Mothma sat up weakly.
Nearby a medical droid tended the silent monitoring and life support systems attached to the chief of state's body. Her skin looked grayish, as if it had already died and was waiting to fall off her bones. As she declined, she had given up all pretense of hiding her failing health. According to Leia, Mon Mothma had only a few weeks to live with her strange, debilitating disease. Seeing the woman now, though, Han wouldn't have laid odds she would survive even that long.
What exactly, Mon Mothma began, then paused to heave a deep breath, do you need to know, General Solo?
Han swallowed again.
He couldn't hide the truth, though he hated to admit it.
Kip Duran was my friend, but he went wrong somehow.
He attacked Luke Skywalker.
He took the Suncrusher and blew up the Cauldron Nebula to destroy Admiral Dalla's fleet. Leia and all the Jedi trainees on Yavin just experienced what they called a great disturbance in the Force, and she's convinced that Kip might have done something else. General Rican spoke in his gruff voice, looking at Han with weary eyes. Rican had been the commander of Echo Base on Hoth, and he had seen many hard times. "Our scouts have just come back, General Solo. Your friend did use the Suncrusher again. He destroyed the Carradine Star System, site of the Imperial Military Academy." Han felt his throat go dry, though the news was no great surprise, considering how much Kip hated the Empire. "This slaughter must stop. It goes beyond even the Emperor's atrocities," the aging tactician, General Jan Dadana, said. "The New Republic does not employ such barbarous tactics." "Well, he does," interrupted Garm Belliblis. "And he has obliterated two crucial Imperial targets. While we may not agree with Diran's methods, his success rate is nothing short of astonishing." Mon Mothma interrupted, somehow finding the energy to speak a harsh sentence. "I will not allow this young man to be portrayed as a war hero." She paused for a deep breath and raised her clenched hand to signal that she had not yet finished. "His personal crusade must stop. General Solo, can you halt Kip Duran? I've got to find him first. Give me the reconnaissance information your scouts gathered from the Cauldron Nebula and Carita. Maybe I can track him down. If I could just talk to him face to face, I'm sure I could make the kid see reason." "General Solo, you will have access to everything you desire," Mon Mothma said, spreading her palms on the synthetic stone surface in front of her, as if to support herself. "Do you require a military escort?" "No," he said, "that might scare him off. I'll take the Falcon and go myself. If I'm lucky, maybe I can bring the Suncrusher back, too." Han gazed slowly around the council chamber. "And this time, let's make sure we destroy it completely." Packing the Falcon, Han had almost finished his last-minute emergency preparations when he heard a voice behind him. "Han, old buddy. Need some help?" He glanced over his shoulder to see Lando Calrissian striding toward him across the hangar bay, ducking under the flat aerofoil of an X-wing starfighter. "Just leaving, Lando," he said. "Don't know how long I'll be gone."
"I heard," Lando said.
"Hey, why not let me come along? You'll need a co-pilot, with Chewbacca gone on the Maw mission."
Han hesitated. "I'm doing this by myself. I can't ask anyone else to go with me."
"Han, you're crazy to fly the Falcon alone. You don't know what sort of hostile situations you're going to get into. Who'll be at the controls if you need to go up into the gunwale?" Lando flashed his most winning smile.
"You've got to admit, I'm the obvious choice."
Han sighed. "Chewbacca would be my first choice. I miss that fuzzball, you know. At least he doesn't try to gamble the Falcon away from me."
"Aw, we don't do that anymore, Han," Lando said.
"We promised, remember?"
"How could I forget?"
Han groaned. Lando had beaten him in their last round of sabacc, claiming ownership of the Falcon, and then he had given the ship back to Han, just to impress Mara Jade.
"But what's your take on this, you old pirate?"
Han said, raising his eyebrows.
"Why do you want to come along so bad?"
Lando shuffled his feet on the polished floor of the landing bay. At the other end of the chamber, a sublight engine started up, blat, then coughed as a team of mechanics scrambled over the fuselage of a dismantled A-wing.
"To be honest, I need to get to Kessel within a week."
"But I'm not going anywhere near Kessel," Han said.
"You don't know where you're going yet. You're looking for Kip."
"Point taken. What's at Kessel?"
Han asked.
"I didn't think you'd want to go back there soon, after what happened last time."
"I sure don't. Mara Jade's going to meet me there in a week. We're partners in a new spice mining operation."
He beamed, tossing his burgundy cape over his shoulder. Han tried to cover his skeptical smile. And does Mara herself know about this partnership, or are you just talking big?
Lando looked hurt.
Of course she knows, sort of. Besides, if you get me to Kessel, maybe I can find the Lady Luck again, and I can stop hitching rides with people.
This is getting old.
That's for sure, Han said. All right, if we go near Kessel, I'll take you there, but my priority is tracking Kip.
Of course, Han.
That's understood, Lando said, then mumbled under his breath, just as long as I get to Kessel within a week.
Chapter 7.
As a disembodied spirit, Luke Skywalker could only watch as his Jedi trainees and his sister Leia filed into the grand audience chamber. R2-D2 trundled ahead, like an escort, silently coasting to a stop before the platform on which he lay. The other Jedi trainees stood in a row in front of the motionless form. They stared respectfully at his motionless body as if they were attendees at a funeral. Luke could sense emotion pouring from them, grief, confusion, dismay, and deep anxiety. Leia, he called in his echoing otherworldly voice. Leia, he screamed as loud as he could, trying to break through the other-dimensional walls that restrained him. Leia flinched, but didn't seem to hear. She reached forward to grip the arm of his cold body. He heard her whisper, "I don't know if you can hear me, Luke, but I know you're not dead. I can sense you're still here. We'll find a way to help you. We'll keep trying." She squeezed his limp hand and turned away quickly. She blinked to cast away the tears welling up within her eyes. "Leia," he sighed. He watched as the other Jedi candidates followed her back to the turbolift. Once again he found himself all alone with his paralyzed body, staring at the echoing walls of the Masasi temple. "All right," he said, looking for another solution. If R2 couldn't hear him, and if Leia or the other Jedi trainees could not identify his presence, then perhaps Luke could communicate with someone on his own plane of existence, another glistening Jedi spirit he had spoken to many times before.
"Ben," Luke called.
"Obi-Wan Kenobi, can you hear me?" His voice hummed through the ether. With all the emotional firepower he could dredge from the bottom of his soul, Luke shouted into the silence.
"Ben."
Growing more concerned at hearing no answer, he called for others.
"Yoda."
"Father, Anakin Skywalker." He waited, but there was no response. Until he sensed a coldness ripple through the air like an icicle slowly melting. Words trembled from the walls.
"They can't hear you, Skywalker, but I can."
Luke spun around and saw a crack form in the stone walls. It grew darker as a tar-like silhouette oozed out and congealed into the shape of a cowled man whose features were distinct now that Luke could see him in the spirit plane. The stranger had long black hair, shadowed skin, and the tattoo of a black sun emblazoned on his forehead. His eyes were like chips of obsidian and just as sharp. His mouth bore a cruel scowl, the expression of one who has been betrayed and has had much time to think bitter thoughts. "Exar Kun," Luke said, and the dark spirit understood him perfectly well. "Do you enjoy having your spirit trapped away from your body, Skywalker?" Kun said in a mocking voice. "I have had 4,000 years to get accustomed to it. The first century or two are the worst." Luke glared at him. "You corrupted my students, Exar Kun. You caused the death of Gantoris. You turned Kip Duran against me." Kun laughed. "Perhaps it was your own failings as a teacher. Or their own delusions. What makes you think I'll stay like this for thousands of years?" Luke said. "You will have no choice," Kun answered, "once I have destroyed your physical body. Trapping my own spirit inside these temples was the only way I could survive when the final holocaust came. The allied Jedi Knights devastated the surface of Yavin 4. They killed off the few Masasi people I had kept alive, and they destroyed my own body in the Inferno. My spirit was forced to wait and wait and wait until finally you brought your Jedi students here, students who could hear my voice once they learned how to listen." An echo of fear rang through Luke's mind, but he forced himself to sound calm and brave.
You can't harm my body, Kun. You can't touch anything physical.
I've tried it myself.
Ah, but I know other ways to fight, Kun's spirit said.
And I have had endless millennia to practice.
Rest assured, Skywalker, I will destroy you.
As if finished with his taunting, Kun sank like smoke through the cracks in the polished flagstones, descending to the heart of the great temple. In his wake he left Luke alone but more determined than ever to break free from his ethereal prison.
He would find a way.
A Jedi could always find a way. When the twins suddenly started crying on their cots beside her, Leia woke up with a feeling of dread.
It's Uncle Luke.
Jaina said.
He's gonna be hurt, Jason said.
Leia bolted upright and felt a series of whistling, tingling vibrations through her body, unlike anything she had ever encountered before. She sensed more than heard the howling wind, a gathering storm trapped inside the temple, centered in the grand audience chamber where Luke lay. She threw on a white robe, cinched it around her waist, and dashed into the hall. Several other Jedi trainees emerged from their quarters, also sensing an indefinable dread. The twins jumped out of their beds, and Leia called back to them, "You two stay here." She doubted they would.
"R2, watch over them," she shouted to the droid, who was buzzing in confusion down the corridors, lights flashing.
"Come to the grand audience chamber," Leia cried to the Jedi trainees.
"Hurry."
R2 spun around in the hall and returned to the children's quarters. The droid's confused bleeps and warbles followed Leia down the hall. She rode the turbo lift to the top. When it stopped and opened its doors, storm winds howled around the vast, open chamber. Leia stumbled out into a cyclone. Cold rivers of air gushed through the horizontal skylights high in the walls. Ice crystals sparkled as the temperature plummeted. Wind drawn in from every direction struck the center of the room and spun around, corkscrewing, picking up speed in an irresistible force.
Stream.
The old Bespin hermit stood on the outskirts of the storm with his brown Jedi robe flapping around him. His wild gray hair writhed around his head as if charged with static. His lips mumbled something incomprehensible, and his eyes remained closed as if he were having a nightmare. Leia knew that even powerful Jedi could not manipulate large-scale phenomena like the weather, but they could move objects, and she realized that was what Stream did now. Not changing the weather, but simply moving the air, drawing it in from all directions, creating a self-contained but destructive tornado that struck toward Luke's body.
"No," she shouted into the starving wind.
"Stream." The cyclone struck Luke, buffeted his body, and lifted it into the air. Leia ran toward her paralyzed brother, feet barely touching the ground as the powerful winds knocked her sideways. The storm wrenched her off balance, and she found herself thrown through the air, flying like an insect toward the stone walls. She spun around and reached out, calming herself enough to use her own abilities with the Force to nudge her body away. Instead of being crushed against the stone blocks, she slid softly to the floor. Luke's body continued rising, tugged upward by the hurricane. His Jedi robe wound around him as the winds spun him like a corpse launched out of a star freighter airlock into the grave of space.
Stream didn't seem aware of what he was doing.
Leia staggered to her feet again and jumped. This time she rode the circling air currents, flying around the fringe of the cyclone toward her helpless brother. She reached out to grab the tail of his robe, felt her fingers clutch rough fabric, and then burn as the robe was snatched away from her. She fell back to the floor. Luke had been drawn up into the tornado's mouth, rising toward the skylights.
"Luke," she cried.
"Please help me." She had no idea if he could hear her, or if he could do anything. Gathering strength in her leg muscles, she leaped into the air again. It might be possible to use her Jedi skills of levitation for a brief moment. Luke had done it several times, although she herself had never mastered the skill. Now, though, it mattered more than it ever had before. As Leia sprang upward, the wind caught her. She rose high enough to grab Luke's body. She wrapped her arms around his waist, twisted her legs around his ankles, holding him, hoping her weight would drag him down. But as they started to drop, the winds picked up in intensity, howling and roaring. Leia's skin went numb from the blinding wintry cold. They shot toward the roof of the grand audience chamber, toward the widest skylight, where jagged icicles hung like javelins. Leia suddenly knew what Streen intended to do to them, whether consciously or unconsciously. They would be sucked out of the great temple, tossed high into the sky, and then allowed to crash thousands of feet to the spear-pointed branches of the jungle canopy. The turbolift door opened. Kirana T charged out, followed by Tion and Cam Solasar. "Stop, Streen!" Leia shouted. Kirana T reacted instantly. She wore thin but supple red armor from the scaled hides of reptiles from Dathomir. She had been a warrior on her own world, fighting with untrained and unhoned skill in the Force, but she had also fought in physical combat as well. Kirana T launched herself forward on long, muscular legs, ducking her head as she charged into the cyclonic wind that surrounded Streen. The old hermit stood entranced, spinning slowly around with his arms dangling at his sides and his fingertips spread apart, as if trying to catch something. Kirana T staggered as she hit the wind, but she wrenched her head aside, spread her legs, and dug the toes of her bare feet against the stone floor for traction. She shoved forward into the wind and finally shattered through into the dead zone of the storm. She tackled Streen to the flagstone floor and locked his arms behind his back. Streen cried out, then blinked his eyes open. He looked wildly around in confusion. Instantly the wind stopped blowing. The air fell still. High up at the ceiling of the grand audience chamber, Leia and Luke plunged toward the unforgiving flagstones below. Luke fell like a doll, and Leia tried to remember how to use her levitation skills, but her mind went blank with panic. Tion and Cam Solasar raced forward, stretching out their arms, using what they had been taught. Less than a meter above the crushing stones, Leia found herself slowed, pausing in the air beside Luke's body. They drifted gently to the floor. Leia cradled Luke against her, but her brother did not respond. Streen sat up, and Cam Solasar ran over to help Kirana T hold him. The old hermit began to weep. Cam Solasar gnashed his teeth and looked as if he wanted to kill the old hermit then and there, but Kirana T stopped him. "Don't hurt him," she said. "He doesn't know what he was doing." "A nightmare," Streen said, "the dark man talking to me. Whispering to me. He never lets go. I was fighting him in my dream." Streen looked around for sympathy or encouragement. "I was going to kill him and save us all, but you woke me." At last Streen realized where he was. He looked around the grand audience chamber until his gaze fell upon Leia holding Luke. "He tricked you, Streen," Kirana T said in a hard voice. "You weren't fighting the dark man. He was manipulating you. You were his tool. If we hadn't stopped you, you would have destroyed Master Skywalker." Streen began sobbing. On the raised platform, Tion helped Leia lift Luke back onto the stone table. "He doesn't seem injured," Leia said. "By sheer luck," Tion said. She wondered aloud, did the ancient Jedi Knights have to deal with challenges like this? "If they did," Leia said, "I hope you managed to find the old stories. We need to learn what those Jedi did to defeat their enemies." Streen stood, shaking himself free of the gripping hands of Kirana T and Cam Solasar. The old man's face was filled with outrage. "We must destroy the dark man," Streen said, "before he kills all of us." Leia felt a grip of unbearable cold in her heart, knowing that Streen was right. Chapter 8. Being chief administrator of Maw Installation was a great enough burden under normal circumstances, but Tol Sivrin had never counted on doing it without Imperial assistance. Standing inside the empty conference room, Sivrin stroked his sensitive Twi'lek headtails and stared out the viewport into the empty space around the secret facility. He had never liked Admiral Dalla and her overbearing manner. In the years they had been stranded in the Maw, Sivrin had never felt as though she understood his mission to create new weapons of mass destruction for Grand Moff Tarkin, to whom they both owed enormous favors. Dala's four Star Destroyers had been assigned to protect Sivrin and the precious weapons scientists, but Dala had refused to accept her subordinate position in the scheme of things. She had let a few rebel prisoners steal the Suncrusher and kidnap one of Sivrin's best weapons designers, Quizux. Then Dala had abandoned her post to chase after the spies, leaving him alone and unprotected. Sivrin paced the conference room, puffed with pride and saddled with disappointment. He shook his head, and his two worm-like head appendages slid across his tunic with a tingle of sensory perceptions. He gripped one of the head tails and wrapped it heavily around his shoulders. The handful of stormtroopers Dala had left behind served little purpose. Tol Sivrin had compiled a full tally of the soldiers, 123. He'd filled out official reports, gathered their service records, compiled information that might someday be useful. It wasn't clear to him exactly how this information would be useful, but Sivrin had based his career on compiling reports and gathering information. Someone, somewhere, would find it worthwhile. The stormtroopers obeyed his orders, that was what stormtroopers did, after all, but he was no military commander. He didn't know how to deploy the soldiers if Maw installation was ever attacked by rebel invaders. During the last month he had kept the Maw scientists working harder to come up with better prototypes and functional defenses, writing contingency plans and emergency procedures, outlining scenarios and prescribed responses to every situation. Being prepared is our best weapon, he thought. Tol Sivrin would never stop being prepared. He had requested frequent progress reports from his researchers, insisting that he be kept completely up to date. The storage room adjacent to his office was piled high with hardcopy documents and demonstration models of various concepts. He didn't have time to review them all, of course, but it comforted him just to know they were there. He heard footsteps approach, and saw his four primary division leaders escorted to the morning briefing by their designated stormtrooper bodyguards. Tol Sivrin did not turn to greet them, staring with a thrill of pride at the huge spherical skeleton of the Death Star prototype rising over the cluster of rocks like a framework moon. The Death Star was the installation's greatest success. Grand Moff Tarkin had taken one look at the prototype and given him a medal on the spot, along with Bevel Lemelisk, its main designer, and Quizux, his primary assistant. The four division leaders took their seats around the briefing table, each bringing a hot beverage, each munching on a reconstituted morning pastry. Each carried a hard copy printout of the morning's agenda. Sivrin decided he would keep the meeting brief and to the point, no longer than 2, possibly 3, hours. They didn't have much to discuss anyway. As the Death Star orbited out of sight overhead, he turned to face his four top managers. Doxin was a man wider than he was tall, completely bald except for very dark, very narrow eyebrows that looked like thin wires burned into his forehead. His lips were thick enough that he could have balanced a stylus on them when he smiled. Doxin was in charge of high-energy concepts and implementations. Next to him sat Galanda. Tall and hawkish with an angular face, pointed chin, and aquiline nose that gave her face the general shape of a Star Destroyer, she was about as beautiful as a Gundark. Galanda led the Artillery Innovations and Tactical Deployments section. In 10 years she had not stopped complaining about how foolish it was to do artillery research in the middle of a black hole cluster where the fluctuating gravity ruined her calculations and made every test a pointless exercise. The third division leader, Yem, was a demonic-looking Deveronian who excelled in saying the right thing at the right time. He supervised documentation and legal counsel. Last of all, seated at the far corner of the table, was Wormin, a tall, one-armed brute. His skin had a purplish-green cast that left his origin in question. Wormin was in charge of plant operations and keeping Maw installation up and running. "Good morning, everyone," Tol Sivrin said, seating himself at the head of the table and tapping his needle claws on the tabletop. "I see you've all brought your agendas with you. Excellent." He scowled at the four stormtroopers standing outside the door. "Captain, please step outside and close the door. This is a private, high-level meeting. The stormtrooper made no answer as he ushered his companions outside and sealed the door with a hiss of compressed gases.
"There," Tol Sivrin said, shuffling papers in front of him.
"I'd like you each to report on recent activities in your division. After we've discussed the possible implications of anything new, we can then brainstorm strategies. I take it our revised emergency plans have been distributed to all members of this facility?"
Sivrin looked at Yem, the paperwork person.
The Deveronian smiled pleasantly and nodded. The horns on his head bobbed up and down.
"Yes, Director. Everyone has received a copy of the full 365-page hard copy document with instructions to read it diligently."
"Good," Sivrin said, checking off the first item on his agenda.
"We'll leave time at the end of the meeting for new business, but I'd like to move right along. I still have a lot of reports to review.
Worman, would you like to begin?"
The One-Armed Plant Operations Division leader rumbled through a detailed report on their supplies, their power consumption rates, the expected duration of fuel cells in the power reactor. Worman's only concern was that they were running low on spare parts, and he doubted they would ever receive another shipment from the outside.
Tol Sivrin duly noted that fact in his log pad.
Next, Doxin slurped his hot beverage and gave a report of a new weapon his scientists had been testing.
"It's a metal crystal phase shifter," Doxin said.
"MCPS for short."
"Hmm," Tol Sivrin said, tapping his chin with a long claw.
"We'll have to think of a catchier name before we present it to the Imperials."
"It's just a working acronym," Doxin said, embarrassed.
"We've constructed a functioning model, though our results have been inconsistent. The tests have given us reason to hope for a successful larger-scale implementation."
"And what exactly does it do?"
Tol Sivrin asked.
Doxin scowled at him.
"Director, I've filed several reports over the past 7 weeks.
Haven't you read them?"
Sivrin flinched his headtails instinctively.
"I'm a busy man, and I can't recall everything I read," he said.
"Especially about a project with such an uninspired name.
Refresh my memory, please."
Doxin grew animated as he spoke.
"The MCPS field alters the crystalline structure of metals, such as those in starship hulls.
The MCPS can penetrate conventional shielding and turn hull plates into powder.
The actual physics is more complicated, of course, this is just an executive summary."
"Yes, yes," Tol Sivrin said.
"That sounds very good.
What were these problems you encountered?"
"Well, the MCPS worked effectively over only about 1% of the surface area on our test plate.
So it might not be terribly useful,"
Tol Sivrin said.
Doxin rubbed his fingers across the polished table surface, making a squeaking sound.
"Not exactly true, Director. The 1% effectiveness was distributed over a wide area, leaving pinhole failures over the entire surface.
Such a loss of integrity would be enough to destroy any ship."
Sivrin grinned.
"Ah, very good. Continue your studies and continue filing those excellent reports."
Galanda, the hatchet-faced woman in charge of artillery deployment and tactical innovations, talked about cluster resonance shells based in part upon preliminary theoretical work for the Suncrusher.
Yem interrupted Galanda's summary by standing up and crying out.
Sivrin frowned at him.
"It's not time for new business, Yem."
"But, Director,"
Yem said, gesturing madly toward the viewport.
The other division leaders stood in an uproar.
Tol Sivrin finally whirled to see silhouettes against the gaseous backdrop of the mall. His Twi'lek headtails uncurled and stood out straight behind him.
A fleet of rebel warships appeared, inside the mall.
The invasion force he had dreaded for so long, had finally arrived.
With two Corellian corvettes at point, and two at his flanks, General Wedge Antilles brought the escort frigate Yavaris toward the mismatched cluster of rocks that formed Maw installation. Quizux stood pale blue and beautiful at the observation station beside him, looking tense yet eager to ransack her old quarters for clues to her lost memories. Maw installation, Wedge said into the comm channel.
This is General Antilles, commander of the New Republic Occupation Fleet. Please respond to discuss terms of your surrender.
He felt arrogant as he said it, but he knew they had no way of fighting off his fleet. Hidden in the midst of the black holes, without Admiral Dalla's Star Destroyers to defend it, the installation depended on inaccessibility rather than firepower for protection.
As his ships approached the cluster of rocks, Wedge received no response.
But when the open metal framework of the Death Star prototype orbited up from behind the planetoids, he felt a stab of terror.
Shields up, he said instinctively.
But the Death Star did not fire, gracefully orbiting back out of view again.
As Wedge brought his fleet in closer, a tracery of laser fire shot toward them from small buildings and habitation modules on the misshapen asteroids.
Only a few of the beams managed to strike, reflecting harmlessly off the ship's shields.
All right, Wedge said.
Two corvettes.
Surgical strikes only.
We want to remove those defenses, but don't damage the installation itself.
He shot a glance at Qui.
That place holds too much important data to risk losing it.
Wedge watched the enormous banks of engines behind the foremost two corvettes as they rained destructive blasts upon the asteroids.
Bright red spears lanced down to pulverize the rocks.
This is too easy, Wedge said.
A desperate signal came from one of the corvette captains.
His image flickered as he beamed a transmission on the emergency channel.
Something's happening to our hull.
Shields aren't effective.
Some new kind of weapon.
Hull walls are weakening.
Can't pinpoint where.
The transmission cut off as the corvette became a ball of fire and shrapnel.
Back off.
Wedge shouted into the open channel, but the second corvette plunged forward, choosing instead to use his full complement of dual turbo laser cannons as well as a pair of proton torpedoes that had been specially installed for the occupation mission.
Captain Ortola.
Back off.
The captain of the second corvette blasted the nearest planetoid.
Proton torpedoes sizzled with uncontained energy.
Turbolaser blasts ignited volatile gases and flammables, reducing the small planetoid to incandescent dust.
That won't be a problem anymore, sir, Captain Ortola said.
You may deploy the strike forces at your leisure.
Howling warnings shrieked through the Maw installation's intercom, so monotonously, that Tol Siverin found it difficult to plan his speech.
Your attention, please, he said into the intercom.
Remember to follow your emergency procedures.
Outside, stormtroopers hustled up and down the white-tiled corridors.
The stormtrooper captain was yelling and directing his troops to set up defensive positions at vital intersections.
No one bothered to refer to the carefully written and tested contingency scenarios Tol Siverin and his managers had spent so much time developing.
Gritting his pointed teeth in annoyance, Siverin raised his voice into the intercom.
If you need another copy of your emergency procedures, or if you have difficulty finding one, contact your respective division leader immediately.
We will see to it that you receive one.
Hanging above Maw installation, the rebel ships looked like nightmarish constructions, brushing aside the installation's defensive lasers as if they were mere insect bites.
Doxin sat by an interlaboratory communication station and cheered as he saw one of the rebel corvettes crumble, disintegrating into a cloud of pulverized metal plate and escaping fuel and coolant gases.
It worked.
Doxin said.
The MCPS worked.
He tapped the receiving jack in his ear, listened, and frowned with his enormous lips.
When Doxin wrinkled the brow on his bald head, the ridges rippled all the way up to his crown like rugged terrain treads.
Unfortunately, we won't get a second shot, Director.
The MCPS seems to have malfunctioned, Doxin said.
But I do believe the original success against an actual target has proved the system worthy of additional development.
Indeed, Tol Siverin agreed, looking admiringly at the expanding cloud of debris from the corvette.
We must have a follow-up meeting.
The system is presently offline, Doxin said.
The second rebel corvette came in with all weapons blazing, and the asteroid housing the offices and labs of the high-energy concepts incinerated under the barrage.
It appears to be unquestionably out of commission, Sivrin said. Doxin was deeply disappointed. Now we'll never conduct a post-shot analysis, he said with a sigh. It's going to be hard to compile a full report without actual data. A loud whump reverberated through the facility. Tol Sivrin peered out into the hall as his division leaders crowded to get a view. White and gray smoke curled down the corridors, clogging the ventilation systems. The screens on the computer monitors inside the conference room went blank. As Sivrin stood up to demand an explanation, the lights in all the offices winked out, replaced by a pale green glow of emergency systems. The stormtrooper captain rushed up with a clatter of boots on the tiled floor. Captain, what's going on? Tol Sivrin said. Report. We have just successfully destroyed the main computer core, sir, he said. You did what? Sivrin asked. The captain continued in his staccato voice. We need your personal codes to access the backup files, Director. We will irradiate them to erase the classified information. Is that in the emergency procedures? Tol Sivrin looked from right to left for an answer from his division leaders. He picked up the hard copy of the emergency procedures manual. Captain, which page did you find that on? Sir, we cannot allow our vital data to fall into rebel hands. The computer backups must be destroyed before the invaders take possession of this facility. I'm not sure we addressed that contingency when we wrote the manual, Galanda said with a shrug, flipping pages as well. Perhaps we'll have to put that in an addendum. Yem suggested. Standing, Worman shuffled through the papers with his one meaty hand. Director, I see here in section 5.4, in the event of rebel invasion, paragraph C. If such an invasion appears likely to succeed in gaining possession of the installation, I am to lead my team in a mission to the power reactor asteroid and destroy the cooling towers, so that the system will go supercritical, and wipe out both this base and the invaders as well. Good, good. Tol Sivrin said, finding the right page and verifying the words for himself. Get to it. Worman stood up. His swarthy greenish-purple skin flushed darker. All these procedures have been approved, Director, but I don't quite follow our next step. How is my team going to get to safety? In fact, how are any of us going to get to safety once I've set up the chain reaction? A stormtrooper's voice cut through the alarm chatter on the intercom. Rebel troops have entered the base. Rebel troops have entered the words ended in a squawk of dead static. Sound the evacuation order, Sivrin said, beleaguered. He stared out the sweeping viewing window with his close-set, beady eyes. Rebel battleships pummeled the installation. Then a glinting metal framework rose into view, an armillary sphere the size of a small moon. Just go and take care of the reactors, Worman, Tol Sivrin said. We'll fall back and evacuate to the Death Star prototype. We can swing by and pick you up, then make our escape. We'll abandon the rebels to their deaths, and take our precious knowledge back to the Empire. Three transports bearing New Republic strike teams landed on the installation's central asteroid, blasting through the closed bay doors with their forward laser cannons. As the transports opened egress doors like mechanical wings, the teams flooded out of the passenger compartments and fanned into defensive phalanxes. Crouched low, heads ducked behind blaster-resistant armor, they held high-energy rifles in front of them. Chewbacca let out a Wookiee bellow as he thumped down the ramp, holding his bowcaster in front of him. He squeezed a hairy paw around the stock and pointed the crossbow-shaped weapon. His fur bristled. He smelled smoke, oil, and coolant fumes. Chewbacca scooped the air with his hairy paw, gesturing for the elite team of Page's commandos to follow. Blaster shots rang out as four stormtroopers fired from ambush. A member of one of the other strike teams went down, then 40 blaster bolts converged on the Imperial soldiers. Chewbacca remembered being a prisoner in the Maw installation, when he had been forced to perform maintenance on Admiral Dallas ships. He had been tempted to sabotage one of their Gamma-class assault shuttles, but knew that it would only get him killed while causing no irreparable harm to the Imperial forces. Now, though, Chewbacca kept thinking of the other Wookiee slaves. He remembered their bowed heads and patchy fur, their gaunt frames. The fire in their eyes had gone out after years of hard and hopeless labor. With a barely contained snarl, he also remembered the sadistic lump of a man who served as the Wookiee keeper, watching over the slave detail no matter where they were assigned. His blazing eyes, broken glass voice, and deadly force whip had kept the Wookiees in line through intimidation. Alarms shrieked through the intercoms, pumping Chewbacca's adrenaline and anger. He growled for the teams to hurry. He thought about C-3PO still on board the flagship Yavaris and was glad the protocol droid would not be in all the crossfire now. Chewbacca didn't want to have to put 3PO back together all over again. He approached a vast rock-walled workroom, where he remembered performing endless hours of heavy labor. The doors stood sealed by heavy blast shields with rivets the size of Chewbacca's knuckles. He hammered on the metal door with his flat palm. Behind him, Page's commandos rummaged in their packs. Two members rushed forward with thermal detonators in each hand. They placed the detonators at critical junctures on the blast door and flicked the timer switches. Amber lights winked on and off, counting down. "Back away," one yelled. Chewbacca loped after the team as they ran around the corner just in time to hear a muffled explosion. An instant later, a much louder sound reverberated as the heavy blast door clanged to the floor. "Move out," the strike team leader said. Chewbacca charged forward through the smoke as he pushed into the sealed bay. He heard thin hissing sounds, like lightning strikes mixed with outraged bellows of pain. The captive Wookiees were in such a frenzied state that they had forgotten their own language. As the smoke cleared, Chewbacca was disappointed to find the battle already over, but he was elated that the Wookiees had finally taken a stand upon hearing the alarms and sensing that the tide of their misery had turned. 9 Wookiees had converged on the Keeper, who now stood backed against a half-disassembled Lambda-class Imperial shuttle. The Keeper was barrel-shaped with oily skin enhanced by a sheen of terrified sweat. His lips pulled back in a snarl of defiance, and he kept lashing out with serpent strikes of his force whip. The Wookiees growled, trying to come close enough to rip him apart with their claws. Chewbacca let out his own roar of challenge. Some of the Wookiees glanced up at the rescue force, but other hairy giants were so transfixed by their chance to get the Keeper that they paid no heed. "Drop your weapon," the commando team leader said to the Keeper. All of the blaster rifles were directed toward him. It amused Chewbacca to see the cruel man glance at the New Republic force with an expression of relief. The Wookiees continued to snarl. They looked worse now than they had appeared only months earlier. No doubt without the protection of Admiral Dalla's fleet, the Keeper had forced the slaves to work even harder to arrange other defenses for Maw installation. "Drop your weapon, I said," the strike team commander insisted. The Keeper flicked his force whip once more, driving the Wookiee mob back. Chewbacca saw the 3 largest males in front, their fur streaked and patchy, burned from lashes of the whip and shiny with wax-like welts from old scars. The oldest gray-furred Wookiee, whom Chewbacca remembered as Norowan, crouched by the edge of the shuttle, hiding under the sharp panels of the ship's upfold wings. The old Wookiee's bones seemed twisted and crushed from years of labor, but the anger in his eyes was brighter than a star. The Keeper raised his force whip, stared at the Wookiees, then at Page's commandos. The human team leader fired a warning shot, which spanged off the chamber walls. The Keeper raised his other hand in surrender, then let the handle of his force whip fall to the ground. It clinked on the smooth deck plates. "All right, now, back away," the team leader said. Chewbacca offered his own words in the Wookiee language. The astonished prisoners stood tense for a moment. The Keeper looked ready to collapse in terror, when suddenly old Norowan dived to the floor, lunging with a hairy paw to snatch the handle of the whip. He fumbled the activation switches. The Keeper shrieked and backed against the wall, looking for someplace to hide. Chewbacca yelled for the Wookiees to stop, but they didn't hear him as they all surged forward, claws extended, ready to shred the Keeper into bloody pieces. Noruan sprang upon the man's barrel-like form. Though he was misshapen and old, the hunched Wookiee gripped the force whip like a club and tackled the keeper to the floor. The burly man screamed and flailed. The other Wookiees fell upon him. Noruan jammed the handle of the force whip into the keeper's face and switched on the weapon at full power. The lance of lashing energy drilled into the keeper's head, skirling fireworks inside his brainpan. Sparks came out of his eye sockets, until the keeper's skull shattered, showering the hysterical Wookiee prisoners with gore. Silence thundered down upon the chamber. Chewbacca walked carefully forward as the surviving Wookiees withered. Without any stamina or fury, they backed away from the corpse of their tormentor. Old Noruan stood again and stared blankly down at the force whip in his hand. He let it drop. It struck the floor with a hollow sound, and Noruan crumpled beside it. His body shuddered, and he made hollow sounds as he wept. Tol Sivrin tried to find a comfortable place to sit back and relax in the pilot compartment of the Death Star, but the prototype had not been designed for niceties. Racks of equipment stood surrounded by bare wires and clumsy welds. Girders and reinforced framework blocked his view of most of the embattled installation, but he could see that the rebel forces had overrun the facility. At the outer perimeter of the clustered planetoids, the tangled cooling towers and radiation vanes of the power reactor suddenly glowed bright and began to collapse. Worman's gruff voice came over the radio. "Director Sivrin, our explosives have destroyed the coolant systems. The power reactor will soon go supercritical. I don't think the attackers can stop it. Maw installation is doomed." "Very well, Wernan," Sivrin said, dismayed at the loss of capital equipment, but what could he do, after all? His Imperial guardians had deserted him. He and his division leaders had done quite a creditable job of putting up a fight. Without any military help, they couldn't be expected to succeed against a well-armed strike force, could they? Besides, they were following established procedure. No one could fault them for that. Sivrin looked at the stormtrooper captain and at the other three division leaders. The rest of the Maw scientists and stormtrooper contingents had taken refuge inside the prototype supply and control rooms. "I have not had a chance to read the complete technical readouts of this battle station prototype." Tol Sivrin looked around. "Does anyone know how to fly this vessel?" Galanda looked at Doxin, who in turn looked at Yem. The stormtrooper captain said, "I have had some experience flying attack vehicles, sir. Perhaps I can interpret the controls."
"Good, Captain," Tol Sivrin said.
He stood up from his command chair. "Do you need to sit here?"
"No need, sir. I can handle it from the pilot station."
The captain went over to a bolted together row of controls. "They must have detected Worman's explosions," Doxin said, watching the rebel attack ships clustered around the reactor planetoid. Two more shuttles descended as teams were deployed down to the power station. The combined rebel firepower would block all rescue attempts. "Now, how are we supposed to get Worman?" Sivrin said. Yem began to flip through the emergency procedures manual again. "I don't think we addressed that contingency either." Tol Sivrin's headtails thrashed in extreme annoyance. "That's not very good, is it?" He scowled, trying to figure out how he could adapt on the spot. Twi'leks were good at adapting. Sivrin had managed to adapt when he left his home planet of Ryloth. He had adapted when Moff Tarkin had assigned him as director of the think tank. Now he would adapt his plans again to make the best of a situation that was growing worse by the minute. "All right, so there's no time to rescue Worman. Change of plans. Our duty is to the Empire. We must take this Death Star prototype and make a rapid retreat." Worman himself had seen the rebel strike teams coming down to retake the reactor planetoid, and he contacted Tol Sivrin again with a more frantic tenor in his voice. "Director, what can I do to assist you? How are you planning to rescue us?" Tol Sivrin opened the channel and said in his gravest, most sincere voice, "Worman, I just want you to know how much I admire and respect you for your years of service.
I regret that your retirement cannot be as long and as happy as I had hoped it would be. Once again, accept my appreciation.
Thank you.
He signed off, then turned to the stormtrooper captain.
We need to get out of here, now.
When the heaviest fighting began to die away, Qui Zux shuttled down to the installation with Wedge Antilles. Qui saw the planetoids growing larger as they approached. She had spent most of her life down there, but she remembered little of it. Other than the destruction of the first corvette, the New Republic fleet had suffered minimal losses. The Maw scientists had put up even less resistance than Wedge had feared. Qui looked forward now to going through her old labs, eager to find her own files in hopes of answering some of her questions, but afraid to learn the answers. Wedge reached over to hold her hand.
It'll be fine. You'll be a great help.
Wait and see. She looked longingly at him with her large eyes.
I'll do my best.
But something caught her attention, and she pointed quickly.
Look, Wedge.
We've got to stop it. The Death Star prototype rose away from Maw installation under its own power, glistening in the reflected light of the gas cloud. According to my own records, Maw installation had a fully functional prototype, Qui said. If they take that Death Star into New Republic space. Before she could complete her sentence, the gigantic sphere of the Death Star shot away toward the edge of the black hole cluster and vanished into the masking clouds of superhot gas. End of part 1. This book will be released in segments each week on our YouTube channel, free of charge. However, to help support the costs involved in creating this audiobook, the entire book is available now to our Patreon supporters. If you would like to listen to this entire book early, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. Thank you for listening, and may the Force be with you, always.